Focus. Yeah, so we are beginning after the lunch session. So this the group which is now going to present is from there is a nearby study center which is called as M-Word Learning Center. So it is a study center, like it has a library and a space. So we have started a cube program and they have set up a lab there. So they actually have now plenty of Moina. They also have plenty of fruit fly. They also algae. So they will be presenting about their Moina work, how they have started the, from nothing they have started a lab, so they will be talking about it. Yeah.
Hi friends, my name is Gulsad, his name is Bindu, he is 10, his name is Isad. We are connected to M-Power and today we are going to present on Moina, which we have worked on, I want to tell you about that. फर्स्ट टाइम मैं एम पावर लाइब्रेरी सेंटर में मुझे क्यूब के बारे में पता चला कि क्यूब क्या है. वहाँ पे मुझे अरुणन सर, जय सर और मयूर सर, आरिफ, इन लोगों ने मुझे मुझसे मिला और हम लोगों को बताया कि क्यूब क्या है. हम हफ्ते में दो दिन क्यूब में मिलते हैं, एम पावर लाइब्रेरी सेंटर में मिलते हैं.
व्हाट इज ए क्यूब? क्यूब का मैं पहले फुल फॉर्म बताना चाहूँगी. कोलैबोरेशन, एजुकेशन, अंडरस्टैंडिंग, बायोलॉजी, एजुकेशन. ये डिफरेंट वे टू लर्न अबाउट साइंस. ये एक ऐसा जागरूकता पैदा करती है, जिज्ञासा पैदा करती है, जो क्यों है और किस लिए और कैसे हुआ. साइंटिफिक साइंस को समझने का जो इंफॉर्मेशन है वो करेक्ट है कि नहीं है, उसको इन्वेस्टिगेट करने का. ये एक सिंपल ऑर्गेनिज्म के थ्रू हम समझ सकते हैं अच्छी तरह से किस तरह से हम पढ़ाई कर सके.
जो हमारा वो है सिस्टम है, सिंपल मॉडल सिस्टम मोइना. जो हम लोगों ने पहला हमारा सेकंड सेटअप था वो 25 जनवरी का था. उस वक्त हम लोगों ने दो बोतल सेलेक्ट की थी जो 500 ml की थी और वो दोनों बोतल को डीसी वाटर से 250 ml डीसी वाटर से फिल किया और उसमें 5-5 मोइना ट्रांसफ़र किए और दोनों में लेबल लगाए 1 drop ऑफ मिल्क दोनों और उसको अपने घर पे सेट कर दिए. उसकी फीडिंग थी मिल्क और दोनों में भी 1 drop ऑफ मिल्क डालते थे. लेकिन इससे पहले भी मैंने कुछ किया था जिसकी वजह से मुझे एक इच्छा जागी कि इसके आगे भी मुझे करनी चाहिए और मुझे कुछ सीखना है और आगे कुछ जानकारी लेनी है. इस वजह से जो हमारा पहला सेटअप था वो भी इससे कुछ डेट अलग थी, कुछ मुझे अलग भी मिला. जो 28 दिसंबर को मैंने की थी वो मेरा फर्स्ट सेटअप था. उस वक्त भी हम लोगों ने दो बोतल सेलेक्ट की थी किए थे जो 500 ml की थी और उसमें भी डीसी वाटर हाफ बोतल फिल किए और उसमें भी हम लोगों ने 5-5 मोइना ट्रांसफ़र किए और उसमें लेबल लगाया एक में 1 drop ऑफ मिल्क का और सेकंड में 5 drop ऑफ मिल्क का और उसको अपने घर पे सेट कर दिए. क्योंकि हम हर बार तो वहाँ लाइब्रेरी सेंटर नहीं जा सकते थे इसलिए वो लैब को हम लोगों ने अपने घर पे किचन के पास सेट कर दिया और उसकी केयर मेरी मम्मी करती थी और वो रोज़ाना हर सुबह उसको मिल्क डालती थी.
ये करने का मकसद ये था हम लोगों की जानना था कि ये मोइना कलरलेस होते हैं और होते हैं तो कौन से पहले होते हैं. 5 drop मिल्क के होते हैं कि 1 drop के, ये जानना था. और उन लोग के बॉटल में कौन से बॉटल में जनसंख्या ज़्यादा बढ़ती है, फर्स्ट वाले ड्रॉप पे कि 5 drop जो मिल्क देते हैं.
इसको फर्स्ट सेटअप करने के बाद हम लोगों ने कुछ चीज़ ऑब्ज़र्व की है. वो ये था कि मतलब मुझे हम लोगों को तीन दिनों के बाद मोइना इंक्रीज मिले और वो 20 days के बाद रेड हो गए. 24 days के बाद उनकी डेथ हो गई क्योंकि उनको ऑक्सीजन की कमी हो गई थी. और मेरी मम्मी का ये कहना है कि बोतल को खुली रखनी चाहिए था तो इसलिए उनकी डेथ हो गई क्योंकि उनको सांस लेने के लिए ऑक्सीजन नहीं मिल रहा था. और 5 drop ऑफ मिल्क का 15 days में ही डेथ हो गई थी.
मोइना और मोना ऑर्गेनाइजम जो अपने ही में खुद इंक्रीज और पॉपुलेशन बढ़ाती है, और वो क्यों
हम लोगों ने ऑब्जर्व करने के बाद कुछ सीखा है वो ये था कि हमें ऐसा लगता है कि मोइना एक ऐसा ऑर्गेनिज्म है जिसको अपनी ही जनसंख्या बढ़ाने, मतलब कि अपनी ही प्रोजनी बढ़ाने में किसी और ऑर्गेनिज्म की ज़रूरत नहीं पड़ती है, वो खुद ही अकेले अपनी ही जनसंख्या बढ़ाता है।
वो इंक्रीज मिल्क उसका फ्रूट है, मिल्क उसका फ्रूट है जिससे वो बैक्टीरिया, मिल्क से बैक्टीरिया बनती है, और बैक्टीरिया और मोइना दोनों को ऑक्सीजन की ज़रूरत होती है, और ऑक्सीजन लेस होने की वजह से जब दोनों को ऑक्सीजन बराबर की मात्रा में चाहिए तो ऑक्सीजन मोइना को कम मिलने की वजह से वो रेड हो गए।
हमारा ये ऑब्जर्वेशन करने के बाद हमें ये अंडरस्टैंडिंग, हमारी ये समझ बनी कि जिस तरह हमें हमें ज़िंदा रहने के लिए सांस लेने की और खाने की ज़रूरत पड़ती है, इसी तरह हर स्मॉल ऑर्गेनिज्म को भी ज़रूरत होती होगी, होती है।
अगला
हेलो, ये जो ये डेटा है ये जैसा कि लोग ने बताया वैसा सेम मॉडल सिस्टम मेरा भी था, तो लेकिन मुझे कुछ डिफरेंट मिला उसके अंदर। जैसे कि जब मैंने किया तो मुझे बॉटल्स में अलगे मिला, जबकि मैंने उसमें अलगे नहीं डाला था। शायद से ये उस वजह से हो सकता है कि डीसी वाटर ज़्यादा दिन तक खुला रहा, या फिर कोई और पार्टिकल्स कहीं और से आके उसमें चले गया या कुछ और। तो मुझे उसमें रोटीफर मिला शायद से, यहाँ मैं क्यूब लैब से जो लेके गया था मोइना, शायद से उसमें रोटीफर हो पहले से, और मैंने उसी को लेके डिवाइड किया सब में, तो शायद से रोटीफर उसकी वजह से बढ़ गया हो, तो मुझे ये सब डिफरेंट मिला, लेकिन ये लोगों को नहीं मिला। तो और मेरे दो दिन जो प्रोजिनी रहते वो दो दिन में हो रहे थे, मेरे जो मैंने मोइना कर रहा था उसके जो प्रोजिनी होते वो दो दो दिन में बढ़ते जा रहे थे, इंक्रीज हो रहे थे। और जैसा लोग ने बताया कि मोइना, एक मोइना कितने बच्चे दे सकता है, एक मोइना कितने प्रोजेनी देता है, तो मैंने वो एक्सपेरिमेंट किया था, तो मैंने देखा कि वो 5 से अबव और अंडर देन 10 इतने प्रोजेनीज दे रहा था। तो ये वीडियो एक दिखाता हूँ, उसमें मोइना है, रोटिफर है, ये देखो, ये फ़ोटो से जब मेरा अलगे मिला था स्टार्ट, ये देखिए रोटीफर इधर है और ये जो है वो मोइना है, और ये रोटीफर का पूरा ग्रुप है। थैंक यू एवरीवन, और मैं जय सर, अरुणन सर और बाकी सबका भी शुक्रिया करना चाहूँगा कि उन लोग ने हम लोग को यहाँ पे आने का दिया और हमको बताया कि क्यूब क्या चीज़ है। तो अभी ये लोग भी कुछ बताना चाहते,
तो मोइना इसे गुलशन और सिप्तिन ने बताया कि मोइना, तो मैं मतलब मोइना पे काम कर रहा हूँ, तो ये देख सकते हो कि मतलब मोइना तो यहाँ पे दिखाया था कि विदाउट माइक्रोस्कोप के बोतल में सिप्तिन ने दिखाया कि मोइना कैसे दिखता है, और यहाँ पे ये मोइना है 10x पे लिया है, और ये मोइना का डायग्राम है। सो मोइना जैसे कि उन्होंने बताया कि मोइना यहाँ से लैब से लेके गए, तो हम लोग को पहले यहाँ से जो मोइना था, तो ये मोइना आया कहाँ से हम लोग के पास, तो यहाँ पे वासी, जब योजा वासी स्टेशन से हम लोग आते हैं तो वहाँ पे नीचे देखा हुआ ब्रिज पड़ता है, तो शायद वहाँ से यहाँ पे जो पहले थे तो वहाँ से वो सब ये मोइना सैंपल्स कलेक्ट करके लेके आए, तो उसमें उनके साथ कैट फिश भी मिला, इम्तियाज़ करके कोई था, तो वहाँ से लेके आए, और वहाँ से लेके आए। तो ये मोइना लाने के बाद उन लोग ने आइडेंटिफाई किया कि मतलब मोइना क्या है, तो मोइना एक लिविंग ऑर्गेनिज्म है, देखा होगा हमने झींगा का भी देखा है, तो झींगे का रिलेटेड साइज है, यहाँ पे देखा होगा तो झींगा और इससे कंपेयर करेंगे तो प्रॉन, तो वैसे ही कुछ सिमिलर दिखता है, मतलब झींगा इतने साइज़ में बड़ा रहता है, तो और इसको माइक्रोस्कोप में देखो तो हम लोग उतना झींगे के इतना साइज़ इसका बड़ा दिखेगा, तो नेकेड आई से दिखेंगे तो एक हम लोग को अराउंड 2 मिलीमीटर का साइज़ इसको ये दिखेगा। मोइना के लिए ये मोइना हम लोग को मिलेगा किधर पे अगर हम लोग ऐसा नॉर्मली अगर ढूंढने जाए तो कहा कि हाइड्रा कल्चर के लिए मैंने पहले ही बता दिया कि हाइड्रा कल्चर के लिए मोइना जरूरी है अगर किसी के पास हाइड्रा है तो हाइड्रा भी हम लोग को लेक पॉन्ड से मिल सकता है यहाँ पे पानी रुका हो वहाँ पे एल्गे तो हम लोग यहाँ पे मोइना पे पॉन्ड और डैम और लेक में मिला तो हम लोग को भी जैसे कि मेको और मतलब पहले भी मेरी टीम थी मतलब मोइना की वो शायद पीछे बैठे हुए हैं वहाँ पे जो भी शायद मेरे साथ में नहीं है तो हम लोग को मोइना हम लोग को गोंडी में मिला था तो ये जो दिख रहा है यहाँ पे पिजन का ये पॉन्ड है उसे पानी पीने के लिए तो हम लोग को यहाँ पे मोइना मिला था और MOR जो लर्निंग सेंटर बता रहे हैं वहाँ पे भी मिला था तो ये मोइना हम लोग को रेनी सीजन में मिला था मोइना भी ये रेनी सीजन मिला फिर उसके बाद हम लोग को हमारे हम लोग के स्कूल के पास एक ग्राउंड है तो हम लोग वहाँ पे मतलब जाते हैं खेलने के लिए तो हम लोग को वहाँ पे भी मिला तो ये स्टैग्नेंट वाटर देख रहे तो ये पूरा गार्डन है और यहाँ जो यहाँ पे ये इसमें है तो यहाँ पे क्या ये पॉन्ड गटर के बाजू में है तो यहाँ पे मतलब मोइना गटर से भी आ सकता है या किसी ने कुछ किया होगा और यहाँ पे क्या है सीधा बारिश का पानी कलेक्ट हुआ है और इसमें हम लोग को मोइना मिला है तो इससे कई क्वेश्चन एक आता है कि मोइना ये यहाँ पे आया कैसे तो ये भी हम लोग आइडेंटिफाई शायद मतलब कुछ एक्सपेरिमेंट इसके ऊपर भी हम लोग कर सकते हैं कि मतलब अगर इसे पानी से भर के रख दिया तो उसके अंदर कुछ दिन बाद मोइना आ सकता है कि नहीं आ सकता है तो अगर हम लोग को अगर मोइना चाहिए तो रेनी सीजन में हम लोग को मिल सकता है अगर हम लोग इसे स्टैग्नेंट वाटर प्लेस के अगर जाए तो चेक करें तो वहाँ पर हम लोग को मोइना मिल सकता है और मोइना हाउ टू कल्चर मोइना तो मोइना करने कल्चर करने के मैंने पहले ही बताया कि हाइड्रा में कैसे मोइना कल्चर तो ये भी वो सेम मेथड यूज़ कर रहे हैं जो भी पहले बताए तो हम लोग दो बोटल्स लेते मोइना दो बोटल्स और डीग्राउंड वाटर मतलब डीसी वाटर जैसे कि मैंने बताया था कि बकेट में रखो पानी जो 24 आवर्स के बाद डीग्राउंडेड हो जाता है तो फिर उसको बोटल में लेके फिर उसमें अगर 500 ml में कर रहे अगर 100 ml बोटल ले रहे या 500 ml बोटल ले रहे तो उसमें उसका हाफ वाटर भरना है और उसमें डेली मिल्क 1 drop 2 drop दे सकते हैं तो ये रिक्वायरमेंट्स पहले मैं बता चुका हूँ एक बार तो ये दो रेड मोइना तो रेड मोइना ये जो देख रहे हैं यहाँ पे है 2 drop में येलो मोइना 3 day तो मतलब 3 अगर रेड मोइना हम लोग को कैसे मिला तो मैंने क्या किया था बोटल्स का सेटअप बनाया था इसमें कि टोटल 6 bottles लिया था उसमें 6 bottles लिया था उसके अंदर 2 drop मिल्क एक में 2 drop मिल्क एक में 4 drop एक में 6 drop मिल्क उसमें तो रेड मोइना हम लोग को 1 drop में नहीं मिलता यहाँ पे मैंने एक गलती किया तो यहाँ पे इसी भी ये 1 drop मिल्क का है और ये 2 drop मिल्क का है तो इसे मैंने बोटल्स बनाया एक 2 bottle 1 drop का 2 bottle 2 drop का 2 bottle 4 drop का 2 bottle 6 drop का तो उसमें अलग अलग नंबर्स मिल्क डालना था डेली तो उसमें क्या ऑब्जर्वेशन मिला तो माइक्रोस्कोप में ऑब्जर्व किया तो मैं रेड मोइना तो यहाँ पे दिख रहा है 2 drop में 3 days में कोई येलो मोइना और ये कलरलेस मोइना है ये 1 drop में यहाँ 4 drop में 3rd day पे रेड मोइना है मतलब तो इतना रेड है ये भी और 1 drop में भी वन ड्रॉप कलरलेस है यहाँ पे 6 drop में रेड मोइना और यहाँ पे 1 drop तो रेड मोइना अगर हम लोग को कल्चर करना है तो रेड मोइना हम लोग अगर 6 drop देंगे 6 या 4 drop तो हम लोग को 6 drop में कन्फर्म 3 days में रेड आ जाते हैं और इसमें शायद 4 days लगेगा रेड मोइना आने में तो इसके बाद अभी ये हीना और चित्रा बताएंगे मतलब रेड मोइना इन लोग भी कल्चर करते हैं उसके बताएंगे रेड मोइना होती कैसे
Hello, my name is Hina and this is Chitra. We actually cultured red moina in the lab. So basically, as Arif explained, moina are something like jinga only. They're insect from crustaceous genus and they are found in...
They're found in pond.
They are found in lakes, pools, tanks and basically wherever the water is tangled. So usually the size of adult moina is from 0.7 to 1 millimeter. Sorry, it's meter. And a young moina size is 0.4 millimeter. Moina basically feeds on bacteria, yeast, fungi, but most preferably they are given bacteria and fungi. Oh, sorry. So Moina has a head part and a trunk and the head. The antenna present is used for the locomotion. There is a brood pouch at the dorsal side of the Moina. In this brood pouch, the embryos and the eggs are developed. They basically in Moina, the brood pouch is open, whereas in Daphnia, it's a closed pouch. Moina can reproduce sexually as well as asexually. Moina generally reproduce after 4 or 7 days of their age, and they can give 4 to 22 progeny at one go, and they give 2 to 6 such brood pouches in their lifetime.
इसकी ये जो डायग्राम यहाँ पे दिख रहा है ये तो ये मतलब पहले हम लोग यहाँ से जब ये लैब में मोइना लेके आए थे तो एक काजल है जैसे दिल्ली में है जैसे काजल जो था उससे पहले कि हम लोग ये मोइना को जो था ये उसको हम लोग डेफनिया बोलते थे तो हम लोग नेट पे सर्च किया ऑर्गेनिज्म तो डेफनिया हम लोग का तो हम लोग सीधा उसको डेफनिया नाम देते हैं यहाँ पे भी लैब में एक दो साल से उसको डेफनिया डेफनिया बोल रहे थे तो काजल ने मुझे फाइंड आउट किया कि मोइना है कि डेफनिया तो उसने क्या उसने भी मतलब उन लोग भी ऐसा कर रहे थे एक्सपेरिमेंट तो उन लोग को भी लगा नहीं कि तुम उन लोग भी डेफनिया डेफनिया बोले तो अचानक से काजल ने शायद ऑब्जर्वेशन कुछ किया जो इसको यहाँ पे दिख रहा है ये माउथ पार्ट में इसका क्या ये एंटीन्यूज है और यहाँ पे इसका ये कफ दिख रहा है और जो डेफनिया का है उसका पॉइंटेड उसका माउथ का है तो इसके इसकी वजह से उसने आइडेंटिफाई किया कि ये मोइना है डेफनिया नहीं है ये काजल ने डेली में कहा
Moina has a special quality that it can resist a wide range of temperature and it can also resist in a very low amount of oxygen content. Basically, Moina, they are studying red Moinas, right? So red Moinas are turned red because of the more production of hemoglobin, which is as oxygen level decreases, they produces more hemoglobin, due to which they also appear red. The further will be experiments.
Hello everyone, if you want to cultivate red Moina, the requirements are, you just need the 5 things that are, you can easily available in every source, like you can get DC water, you know, DC water has been explained, transparent bottle, a drop of milk, and muslin cloth, and 5 Moinas you can start. Basically, we have started with the, on 22nd January, for cultivation of red Moina. So procedure is we have started a project with a 4-1 little bottle. That is we have taken just one bottle that is controlled and another 3 are for cultivating red Moinas. So we have taken 1 liter bottle and we have added 500 ml DC water. In that we have added 10 Moinas. So after that we have added one, we have started with the 1 drop of milk. And of course we have plugged it with the cotton plug. So after, on the third day, what happened, actually we were eagerly waiting for getting the red Moina. So we thought on the third day, on the first day, we were having almost 15 to 20 Moinas. After that, we were having 25 to 30 Moinas. After on the third day, what happened, we were like eagerly waiting for the red Moinas. We should get the red Moinas. Fatafat yaar, jaldi mil jaye, kaise me honge. तो हमने सोचा कि रेड मोइनास मिल ज़्यादा डाल देते हैं तो उससे हो जाएगा तो हमने स्टार्ट 1 ड्रॉप से किया था कंट्रोल में हमने वन ड्रॉप कंट्रोल में डाला और बाकी अनदर 3 बॉटल्स में हम लोग ने 3 ड्रॉप्स डाले तो थर्ड डे पे हमने क्या किया कंट्रोल वाले में हम लोग ने 3 ड्रॉप से स्टार्ट किया एंड बाकी के 3 रिमेनिंग्स में हमने 6 ड्रॉप्स डाले तो आफ्टर ऑन द 7th डे वी हैव फाउंड रेड मोइनास एंड सो दैट वॉज द goof ups. So we have done that. This is the on your. This is colorless Moina and this is red Moina on the 7th day. You can see here. Blue line is for control and the another 3 bottle having red, gray and yellow. So the number has been increased after the red Moina also. But at the on the 14th day. The Moinas were dying. So our main short-term objective was that to cultivate red Moina. After that, our long-term objective was that to find out whether these red moina are getting reversible. Are they getting again colorless or they are getting permanent red? So that was her thing. Thank you. Any questions?
एक चीज़ और, तो यहाँ पे किसी का क्वेश्चन आएगा कि जो इसने कहीं मोइना कल्चर ना किया, मोइना ना लैब में देखो, किसी का क्वेश्चन होगा कि मोइना हम लोग में मिल्क क्यों डाल रहे, किसी का क्वेश्चन सही है मोइना के बोतल में मिल्क क्यों डाल रहे? वैसे हम लोग की जो मोइना का बोतल है तो उसमें क्या, हम लोग डीक्लोरेटेड वाटर जब हम लोग उसको बना रहे तो उसमें क्या बैक्टीरिया रहता है, तो ये बैक्टीरिया ग्रो करने के लिए हम लोग वो मिल्क डालते हैं, मिल्क में बहुत सारे प्रोटीन्स प्रेजेंट है, उसके अगर जैसे कि अभी थोड़ा सा दही लिया उसके अंदर मिल्क डाला तो दही मतलब वो मिल्क दही में कन्वर्ट हो जाता है बैक्टीरिया के ग्रो होने की वजह से। तो इसलिए यहाँ बॉटल्स में जो देखा कि 1 ड्रॉप 2 ड्रॉप 3 ड्रॉप ये सब जो बॉटल्स बना रहे हैं उसमें क्या कर रहे हैं, जैसे कि फर्स्ट बॉटल में 1 ड्रॉप में डाला, सेकेंड बॉटल में 2 ड्रॉप, थर्ड बॉटल में 4 ड्रॉप, फिर 6, फिर 10, ऐसे ऐसे बॉटल हम लोग बैक उसमें क्या ड्रॉप ऑफ मिल्क जैसे हम लोग इंक्रीज़ कर रहे हैं वैसे हम लोग बैक्टीरिया प्रोड्यूस हो रहा है, तो मोइना रेड उसमें वैसे सब लोगों ने बताया मोइना रेड हो रहा है, तो मोइना रेड हो कैसे रहा, क्यों हो रहा है? तो मैंने रेड 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 इसलिए हो रहा है कि 1 ड्रॉप में रेड वैसे बताया कि कलरलेस मोइना है, तो 1 ड्रॉप में क्या है उसमें 1 ड्रॉप मिल डाले, जैसे सेकेंड बॉटल में 2 ड्रॉप मिल, तो 2 ड्रॉप में भी कंपेयर टू 1 ड्रॉप और सेकेंड ड्रॉप में ज़्यादा बैक्टीरिया होगा, तो उसमें बैक्टीरिया ग्रोथ ज़्यादा होगा, इसलिए मतलब कि मोइना बैक्टीरिया पर सर्वाइव हो रहा है, यानी कि मिल्क पर मोइना सर्वाइव हो रहा है, तो बैक्टीरिया उसमें अगर हम लोग कंट्रोल के लिए जैसे 1 ड्रॉप के लिए हम लोग 5 मोइना लिया जिसमें 1 ड्रॉप मिल्क डाला, फिर उसमें बैक्टीरिया मोइना इंक्रीज होगा तो बैक्टीरिया खाएगा, तो सेकंड बोतल में क्या रहा वही सेम नंबर डाल रहे उसमें मिल्क नो डबल कर रहे, तो उसमें बैक्टीरिया ग्रो ज़्यादा हो रहा है, देखिए बोला कि 7 डे में उनको रेड मिल गया, मुझे 4 ड्रॉप में रेड मिल गया, तो उसमें क्या है हम लोग ने बैक्टीरिया ज़्यादा इंक्रीज़ किया, तो बैक्टीरिया भी लिविंग ऑर्गेनिज्म है मोइना भी लिविंग ऑर्गेनिज्म है, तो बैक्टीरिया का भी ऑक्सीजन चाहिए और मोइना का भी ऑक्सीजन चाहिए, तो उसमें जब मिल्क ज़्यादा प्रोड्यूस हम लोग मिल्क ज़्यादा बढ़ा रहे तो उसमें बैक्टीरिया ज़्यादा ग्रो हो रहा है, तो कंपेयर मोइना कम ऑक्सीजन ले रहा है और बैक्टीरिया ज़्यादा ऑक्सीजन ले रहा है, इसलिए मोइना के अंदर एक जहाँ तक मेरे इन्फॉर्मेशन के हिसाब से इसके अंदर हीमोग्लोबिन जीन है, जैसे हम लोग के ब्लड में भी है हीमोग्लोबिन, तो हमारे हीमोग्लोबिन का काम बेसिकली क्या होता है ऑक्सीजन ट्रांसपोर्ट करना, जहाँ पे ऑक्सीजन नहीं है तो वो हीमोग्लोबिन जीन प्रेजेंट है मोइना में, पर उसके अंदर रेड ब्लड सेल्स मोइना में नहीं है, हीमोग्लोबिन जीन सिर्फ उसके हर एक सेल्स में प्रेजेंट है, तो जब मोइना को लो ऑक्सीजन मिलता है तो हीमोग्लोबिन जीन वो प्रोड्यूस करता है तो उससे मोइना रेड हो जाता है, तो इसलिए हम लोग अलग अलग बढ़ाते हैं, हम लोग को रेड मोइना हम लोग स्टडी करने तो जैसे कि कुछ शायद एपिजेनेटिक करके कुछ है तो उसके ऊपर हम लोग शायद ट्राई कर रहे हैं स्टडी करने के लिए, तो हम लोग का शायद आगे का प्लान है वो, मेरा भी इन सब का कुछ भी और भी हो सकता है, वैसे मोइना रेड होता है। थैंक यू।
अच्छा, व्हाट इफ यू पुट अ डैफ, हम फिश कहाँ रखते हैं टैंक में जहाँ पे ऑक्सीजन मिलता है, तो मैं सोच रही थी कि सपोज आपने ऑक्सीजन दिया ओके और फिर भी जानबूझ के मिल्क डाला तो क्या होगा, विल इट नॉट टर्न रेड बिकॉज आई एम सप्लाइंग ऑक्सीजन इन द वाटर, कैन यू डू दिस?
हाँ, वी कैन डू, बट
क्योंकि मोइना का खाना ही बैक्टीरिया है।
नहीं, वो बोल रहे कि अगर हम लोग ऐसा कुछ ऐसा और बोतल ले अब उसके अंदर ऑक्सीजन दे दिया और मिल्क भी फीडिंग करें तो बैक्टीरिया रेड होगा कि कलरलेस होगा, तो उसमें ऑक्सीजन तो हम लोग को एयर ऑक्सीजन देना पड़ेगा, तो अगर हम लोग ये भी ट्राई कर सकते हैं जैसे कि एल्गे है तो हम लोग को मतलब खरीदना पड़ेगा फिर ऑक्सीजन के लिए, किसके पास नहीं तो एक्सपेरिमेंट कैसे भी करेगा ऑक्सीजन देने के लिए, तो एयर का वो खरीदना पड़ेगा, तो हम लोग उसमें
सो विल माय हाइपोथेसिस चेंज इफ आई सप्लाई द ऑक्सीजन, विल द रेडनेस विल मतलब टाइम जितना लगेगा रेड होने के लिए वो कम होगा क्या अगर मैंने ऑक्सीजन सप्लाई किया, और मिल्क का कॉन्सेंट्रेशन ज़्यादा होने के मतलब इवन इफ आई इंक्रीज द मिल्क कॉन्सेंट्रेशन?
हाँ, तो ऑक्सीजन मिला तो इसका मतलब मेरा भी ये थिंकिंग है कि रेड नहीं होगा, तो हम लोग को ये जो अगर हाँ तो रेड मोइना है तो इसके ऊपर एक और मतलब आफ्टर रेड होने के बाद हम लोग को क्या करना है उसके ऊपर कुछ है नहीं, तो इससे जीन्स का मैंने बताया कुछ स्टडी करना है हीमोग्लोबिन जीन, तो उसमें हम लोग क्या करें फिर ये बॉटल्स जो मोइना हम लोग को मिला है तो वही मोइना हम लोग दूसरे बॉटल्स में लेंगे, वही मोइना हम लोग रेड मोइना जिसमें मिल गया हम लोग को 7 डे 5th डे 3rd डे में तो वही मोइना को
सो द जीन एक्सप्रेशन वुड डिफर इन द केस ऑफ द ऑक्सीजन सप्लाई।
हाँ,
बराबर।
हाँ,
सो कैन यू स्टडी द रेगुलेशन बाय सप्लाइंग द ऑक्सीजन फ्रॉम आउटसाइड?
आउटसाइड से हम लोग नहीं कर सकते, हम लोग को उसे रिसीवल चेक करना है, मतलब रेड हो रहा है तो कलरलेस भी होना चाहिए। तो उसके लिए हम लोग दूसरा एक्सपेरिमेंट डिज़ाइन करेंगे, इसी में सेम प्रोसीजर डी सी वाटर 250 ml, उसमें हम लोग क्या करेंगे 10 ड्रॉप अगर मिल्क में जो जिसमें रेड मोइना मिला तो वही मोइना को हम लोग जैसे कंट्रोल में क्या है उसमें रेड नहीं होता है तो उतना बैक्टीरिया का ग्रोथ नहीं होता है, तो उसमें रेड मोइना 5 या 10 रिक्वायरमेंट जितना चाहिए उतना मोइना हम लोग निकाल के उसमें 1 ड्रॉप मिल्क फीडिंग करेंगे, जिससे हम लोग मिल्क उसको फूड दे रहे और दूसरा बोटल में जैसे कंट्रोल में रख सकते हैं कि उसमें नो फीडिंग, हम लोग कुछ फीडिंग नहीं करें, बैक्टीरिया वो पानी में होगा उतने बैक्टीरिया वो खा सकता है, मतलब उतने टाइम तक जिंदा रहेगा, अगर हम लोग बैक्टीरिया दे रहे तो पानी में भी ग्रो होगा बैक्टीरिया, मतलब 1 ड्रॉप भी दे रहे तो उसमें बैक्टीरिया तो ग्रो हो रहा है, तो कंट्रोल में बैक्टीरिया क्या होगा जो बैक्टीरिया प्रेजेंट रहेगा वही उसमें रहेगा डीसी वाटर में, तो उससे हम लोग कंक्लूड कर सकते हैं वो रेड हो रहा है रिसीवल हो रहा है कि निकल रही। तो मेरा अभी मेरा यही है कि मतलब नेक्स्ट अगर करना है मेरे को रिसीवल चेक करना है।
नो हर पॉइंट आई थिंक वाज दैट यू नो आप ऑक्सीजन जो बोलते हैं डू यू हैव एनी एविडेंस कि ऑक्सीजन की वजह से होता है रेड, ऑक्सीजन आपने टेस्ट किया है क्या?
नहीं।
तो ऑक्सीजन कैसे पता?
एविडेंस
नॉर्मल
हाँ
सो यू हैव सीन इट कि वो कलरलेस हुआ, तो एक रेड लिया मैंने मोइना जो पहले से रेड था और उसमें बहुत सारा मिल्क ड्रॉप्स में डाल रहा था, अब मैंने उसको नॉर्मल एक वाटर में डीक्लोरिनेटेड वाटर में डाला है जहाँ मैंने एक ही ड्रॉप मिल्क डाला तो उसमें दोबारा देखा कि इट इज़ बिकमिंग कलरलेस।
हाँ कलरलेस हो गया था, मतलब 3 दिन में हुआ था इसमें सिर्फ 1 ड्रॉप मिल्क लिया। हाँ तो उसके बारे में मतलब कन्फर्म था, मैंने उसी नॉर्मली से निकाल के डाल दिया था, उसके बाद मैंने एक्सपेरिमेंट मतलब किया नहीं तो उसे साइड में से निकाल के डाल दिया था। हाँ
या बट आपने ऑक्सीजन नहीं देखा है ना?
नहीं।
तो अगर आप उन्होंने वही बोला कि अगर आप ऑक्सीजन प्रोवाइड कर रहे हैं रेड मोइना को अगर ऑक्सीजन दे रहे तो वो क्या वाइट हो जाएगा?
हाँ हो जाएगा।
ओके तो वैसा भी कर सकते हैं?
हाँ कर सकते हो वैसा भी।
या डिसॉल्व्ड ऑक्सीजन टेस्ट होता है बट अगर वो हमको नहीं कर अगर सब वो भी कर सकते हैं लेकिन अगर यू कैन डू अनदर थिंग ऑल्सो दैट प्रोवाइड द ऑक्सीजन इंस्टेड ऑफ यू नो से शोइंग दैट देयर इज अ ऑक्सीजन डिक्रीज यू प्रोवाइड द ऑक्सीजन एंड सी दैट इट इज चेंजिंग।
यस
इट कैन बी लाइक ज़्यादा बैक्टीरियल लोड है, अगर ज़्यादा ड्रॉप्स ऑफ मिल्क डाल रहे हैं तो ज़्यादा बैक्टीरियल ग्रोथ होगा और बैक्टीरिया कौन सा रहेगा? वो लैक्टोबैसिलाई रहेगा और लैक्टोबैसिलाई इज माइक्रो एरो टॉलरेंट, मतलब उसको भी एयर लगता है, थोड़ा ऑक्सीजन लगता है, वो एनएरोबिक नहीं है, तो उसके वजह से भी हो सकता है कि वो कंज्यूम कर रहे हैं जितना बॉटल में ऑक्सीजन है तो
हाँ तो वही
मोइना के लिए कम हो जाएगा।
ऑक्सीजन बैक्टीरिया ले रहा है इसीलिए मोइना रेड हो जा रहा है, तो अमाउंट ऑफ 2 ड्रॉप 6 ड्रॉप मिल्क डाल रहे तो उसमें क्या बैक्टीरिया ग्रोथ ज़्यादा हो रहा है कम्पेयर टू मोइना, एक ड्रॉप भी अगर हम लिया तो उसमें हम लोग को बहुत सारे बैक्टीरिया मिल सकते, हम लोग काउंट भी नहीं कर सकते बैक्टीरिया 1 ड्रॉप के अगर दिखे तो।
So, if someone is here from chemistry background or something like someone can suggest a test by which like I can put some chemical 1 drop or like 1 capsule of something into water and it changes color according to the oxygen content. So because oxygen dissolved oxygen test is there but like
the compounds which will take up the oxygen actually milk also
आरिफ आपने बोला कि उसको मोइना में वाइट ब्लड सेल्स होते इसलिए वो
ट्रांसपेरेंट। वाइट ब्लड सेल्स नहीं, मैं ऐसे मतलब आरबीसी नहीं है, रेड ब्लड सेल्स नहीं है, वाइट ब्लड सेल्स नहीं।
हाँ सॉरी रेड ब्लड सेल्स नहीं होता और वो जब बाद में रेड होता है तो वो हीमोग्लोबिन की वजह से रेड होता है,
उसके मतलब
तो रेड ब्लड सेल्स की वजह से भी रेड होते हैं।
हीमोग्लोबिन एक जीन प्रोटीन है जो प्रोटीन उसके अंदर हीमोग्लोबिन जीन भी करके है तो प्रोटीन भी है वो उसके अंदर हर एक सेल में मोइना के प्रेजेंट है तो वो फंक्शन करता है उसके अंदर, इसलिए नहीं है वो उसके हर एक सेल्स में है मोइना के
तो रेड ब्लड सेल्स से नहीं होता रेड
नहीं। जैसे हम लोग में ह्यूमंस में होता है रेड ब्लड सेल्स है वो अगर ब्लड है तो हम लोग ज़्यादा ऑक्सीजन रहेगा नहीं तो नहीं रहेगा तो ऐसा उसमें नहीं मोइन
थैंक यू
हमारे में हीमोग्लोबिन कैरी करने के लिए ऑक्सीजन कैरियर है आरबीसी तो उनमें क्या है
हीमोग्लोबिन आरबीसी के अंदर जो प्रोटीन है वो रिस्पॉन्सिबल है ऑक्सीजन लेने के लिए हीमोग्लोबिन हीमोग्लोबिन जैसे भी हीमोग्लोबिन सुना है हीमोग्लोबिन कम है लो है तो ऑक्सीजन का उसमें तो इसको हीमोग्लोबिन हम लोग रेड ब्लड से नहीं हीमोग्लोबिन उसके अंदर बढ़ाते हैं हम लोग
सो द एक्चुअल कैरियर इज हीमोग्लोबिन हीमोग्लोबिन बाइंड्स विद द ऑक्सीजन मॉलिक्यूल ऑफ ओ टू नाउ इन आर बॉडी दोज हीमोग्लोबिन्स आर ऑन द सर्फेस ऑफ रेड ब्लड सेल्स सो दैट्स वाई आर सेल्स आर वी कॉल इट रेड ब्लड सेल्स बिकॉज वेन दे बाइंड विद ऑक्सीजन दे लुक रेड इट्स ऑक्साइड ऑफ आयरन सो आयरन ऑक्साइड्स आर रेड इन कलर सो इन वॉट ही सेइंग इज इन मोइना दोज प्रोटीन्स दोज हीमोग्लोबिन्स दे आर फ्रीली डिजॉल्व्ड इन द बॉडी फ्लूइड ऑफ मोइना नो स्पेशल सेल इज देयर टू कैरी इट सो दैट्स वाई द होल मोइना अपीयर्स टू बी रेड
Anyone else can even कुछ बोलो
So I saw your pictures of the one drop and the two drop, three drop, four drop, six drop Moinas. Yes. So if you see, the one which is colorless has a body structure that is not so swollen as the one which is red in color. Can you tell me why is that difference?
It's called the EA.
Yeah.
White blood.
हाँ वो इतना बड़ा क्यों है?
हाँ तो एक बार क्वेश्चन आप रिपीट करना
अभी जब दोनों को कंपेयर करोगे तो द कलरलेस वन वो छोटा दिखता है और जो रेड मोइना वो बड़ा दिख रहा है ऐसा क्यों
तो उसमें मतलब इसमें ये जो ये दिख रहा है मतलब मोइना ये भी बड़ा है ये बड़ा है और ये भी बड़ा है तो इस टाइम इसलिए इसका ये जो जो इसके मतलब ज़्यादा ऐसा बैक साइड जो है उसका ज़्यादा ऐसा बड़ा है तो उसमें क्या वो उसका ब्रूड पाउच है तो इसका मीन वो अभी मेल इसमें सेक्सुअल असेक्सुअल फंक्शन एक ही मोइना में दोनों है तो इसमें अभी शायद जो इसमें ब्रूड पाउच ये बड़ा मोइना दिख रही है इसमें क्या अभी शायद मेल मेल है वो मेल मेल वाला फंक्शन कर रहा है और इसमें जो ब्रूड पाउच इसमें दिख रहा है वो शायद फीमेल वाला पार्ट फंक्शन हो रहा है ऐसा छोटा मोइना नहीं छोटा रेड मतलब प्रोजेनिस उसके देखिए तो उसे प्रोजनी हो सकता है तो हम लोग प्रोजनी नहीं देखा जाता रेड हाँ तो ऐसा हम लोग होता है तो अभी ये बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट है तो अगर हम लोग ग्रोथ अगर ग्रोथ जैसे हाइड्रा अलेवे कर रहे हैं छोटा मोइना लेंगे तो हम लोग को कुछ टाइम लगेगा हाइड्रा कल्चर करने में क्योंकि छोटा मोइना उसका प्रोजनी है वो भी कुछ टाइम लेगा वो फंक्शन करने के लिए तो जाके इंक्रीज होगा तो इसलिए अगर हाइड्रा जो भी कल्चर कर रहा है तो उनको कल्चर स्टार्टिंग करने के लिए ग्रेविट मोइना लेना चाहिए तो ग्रेविट मोइना अगर हम लोग लेंगे तो आराम से कम से कम एक वीक में हम लोग को 70-80-100 क्रॉस हो सकता है अब बड़ा मोइना लिए बस छोटा मोइना लिए वो थोड़ा टाइम लेगा छोटा मोइना अगर फर्स्ट डे का अगर लेंगे तो कम से कम थर्ड डे में जाके वो प्रोड्यूस करेगा जैसे कि सिफ्ते ने बोला 10 तो अराउंड 10-12 महीने अभी तक देखा है तो प्रोड्यूस करते एक दिन में एक मोइना
आरिफ
तो ये जो एक मिनट तो जो रेड मोइना का मतलब बोले कि रेड मोइना जो तो इसमें क्या वन ये जो छोटा वाला जो दिख रहा है ये वन ड्रॉप मिल गया तो थ्री ड्रॉप का तो रेड अगर हम लोग को देखना है तो जो थ्री ड्रॉप वाला देखना रहेगा रेड तो उसका हम लोग छोटा मोइना मतलब थ्री ड्रॉप में नहीं बड़ा मोइना साइज़ का है तो हम लोग उसके लिए एक्सप्लेन कर सकते हैं कि जो रेड मोइना का है तो उसको हम लोग अलग से डाल के उसके प्रोजनी पे कर सकते हैं मतलब रेड मोइना का प्रोजनी कलरलेस आ रहा है कि कलरलेस या तो उसको हम लोग को फिर सीधा बॉटल्स फिर बॉटल का हम लोग को मोइना जो है उसमें से उसका प्रोजनी देखना पड़ेगा रेड की कलरलेस हाँ तो इसमें ये और ये क्या दोनों बड़ा साइज तो सिमिलर है पर इसमें का थर्ड वाले में क्या है साइज छोटा है हाँ तो सब रेड होना चाहिए. तो हाँ तो मैंने वो अभी देखा. हाँ तो एक्सपेरिमेंट हम लोग करना पड़ेगा. हाँ हाँ यस मतलब हाँ प्रोजेनी उसका कलरलेस.
अगर वो सवाल क्या है कि छोटा भी रेड होता है, छोटा रेड होता है कि छोटा रेड बर्थ से ही होता है, यू नो वेदर इट इज बॉर्न कलरलेस बाद में रेड होता है कि वो डायरेक्टली रेड पैदा होता है
मदर से.
दैट इज द क्वेश्चन.
या ये एक एक्सपेरिमेंट हो सकता है. और द अदर डे देर वर टू विजिटर्स इन क्यूब लैब एंड देर वर डिस्कसिंग सम स्टूडेंट्स वर डिस्कसिंग देयर आई डोंट नो वेदर यू वर देयर योर ग्राफ पैटर्न यू वर शोइंग. अगर इतने सारे दिनों में सपोज 5 डे या 6 डेज में कलरलेस से रेड हो रहे हैं, तो अगर सपोज कलरलेस उसमें 50 है तो सारे 50 के 50 एक साथ रेड हो रहे क्या ऑन दी 6 डे. तो उन्होंने एक ऐसा पैटर्न प्रेडिक्ट किया है कि शायद 40 रेड हो रहे और 10 या 20 स्टिल येलो है या फिर कलरलेस है. तो वो ग्राफ का पैटर्न देखना बहुत इंटरेस्टिंग रहेगा. आई थिंक अपूर्वा कैन ऑल्सो यू नो बिकम पार्ट ऑफ दिस प्रोजेक्ट एंड आई वॉन्ट एम्बॉर्ड पीपल टू टेक अप दिस एक्सपेरिमेंट ऑफकोर्स अलॉन्ग विद हीना एंड
Actually, we did the experiment with red moinas also. We put the red moinas and we observed that their progeny were colorless only.
आपका क्वेश्चन है आप पूछो मुझे शायद इसका आंसर मालूम होगा.
या
मुझे मालूम होता है.
ओके
तो बोलो ना.
ओके या सो या यू वांट हैव
हाँ इनको कुछ बोलना है. यस
हमारा ये क्वेश्चन है कि नहीं जिस तरह हम ऑक्सीजन लेते हैं और कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड छोड़ते हैं तो क्या ये सिस्टम उनमें भी होता होगा. ये करने के बाद हमारे अंदर ऐसा एक सवाल हुआ है उठा है.
हाँ.
या फिर हम जिस तरह बैक्टीरिया के लिए मिल्क डालते हैं तो हम कुछ और डाल के देखना चाहते हैं और एक नया सेटअप तैयार करना चाहते हैं. अगर आप लोग को कुछ सजेशन लगता है कि हम वो किस तरह कर सकते हैं तो आप बोल सकते हो प्लीज़.
हीमोग्लोबिन जो उन्होंने बोला वो इंसान में भी होता है तो हम लोग में भी वैसा ही वही बता रहे कि वही सिस्टम.
बट मेरा क्वेश्चन ये है कि हम सांस लेते हैं ऑक्सीजन लेते हैं कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड छोड़ते हैं तो पानी में वो किस तरह छोड़ते होंगे.
हम मोइना
जिस तरह फिश छोड़ते होंगे
इसको देखा है कभी कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड छोड़ते हुए.
ओके
क्योंकि अगर हम लोग अगर कभी अगर हम लोग ऐसा एक ग्लास ले अभी हम लोग मुंह से कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड आता है अगर हम लोग ग्लास में अगर फूकेंगे तो उसमें बबल्स निकलेंगे तो फिश जब ब्रीथ करते तभी भी देखा होगा किसी ने अगर ऑब्जर्व किया होगा तो बबल्स निकलते हुए से शायद मोइना अगर कम जैसे कि अगर फिश हम लोग अगर फिश टैंक में अगर देखें तो मोइना जो गिल्स से रहते हैं वहाँ से उसके माउथ से बबल्स आते हैं तो ऐसा कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड मेरे को लगता है कि कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड वो है.
See, I want to divert your attention a little bit. So, of course, first I wanted to just respond to it. You know, this is normally the way how textbooks are written. We take in oxygen and give out oxygen. जब सांस लेते हैं तो ऑक्सीजन अंदर जाता है नहीं सांस लेते हैं तो हवा अंदर जाता है जब सांस बाहर करते हैं तो हवा बाहर आता है. ऑक्सीजन और कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड नहीं हम ले सकते हैं हवा पूरा जाता है सिर्फ ऑक्सीजन नहीं पूरा हवा जाता है अंदर. तो ये जनरल पॉपुलर मिसकंसेप्शन है बहुत लोगों को बट व्हाट एक्चुअली हैपेंस इज पूरा हवा जाता है लंग्स में जहाँ पे ब्लड ज़्यादा होता है वहाँ पे जब एक्सचेंज होता है उस टाइम जो डिजॉल्व्ड कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड और डिजॉल्व्ड ऑक्सीजन दोनों रहता है लेकिन हीमोग्लोबिन सिर्फ ऑक्सीजन को लेता है तो छोड़ते हैं तो फिर दोनों साथ में आ सकते हैं तो ऑक्सीजन भी बाहर आएगा कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड भी बाहर आएगा. सो दैट इज़ वन स्मॉल इम्पॉर्टेंट थिंग दैट यू हैव टू रिमेंबर क्योंकि टेक्स्ट बुक में भी ये जैसे लिखते हैं दैट लीड्स टू लॉट ऑफ कन्फ्यूजन एंड दिस इज समथिंग दैट वी हैव टू थिंक अबाउट. या दिस इज ए कन्फ्यूजन क्रिएटिंग इशू फॉर दैट द टेक्स्ट बुक्स आर ऑल्सो रेस्पॉन्सिबल टीचर्स आर ऑल्सो रेस्पॉन्सिबल. So at least we as cubists, we should try to keep a good eye and critical eye on all these things because we need evidence, right?
Yes.
Or that is why, you know, there are some ministers who said that cows release oxygen. They also take oxygen, right? So now this is what is happening. You know, people who are really ignorant are ruling us. We have to really take into account. Cubists have to head on, say that we challenge you. Come, we'll do the experiment and we'll find out whether which is that cow which will sort of... You have to say the same thing. Cows also take air and they also take out air.
Yes.
Okay, and they also need oxygen. Daphnia also needs oxygen. Bacteria also need oxygen. Okay, so having said that, I want to throw a challenge today. Of course, this is a kind of a challenge that, you know, if you look at the first 2 years of our conferences in CUBE and the presentations, this slide would have been Daphnia. Okay, not Moina. Okay, so we started with Daphnia because that is what is there in biology publications everywhere. So we started with Daphnia. Now today, you haven't heard Daphnia as much as Moina, because you heard only Moina today. That's a good sign. Now the challenge is, if there is anybody anywhere in the country who will bring a native Daphnia, they will get a big prize.
Hi, एक यहाँ पे तो पहले जब presentation हुआ था तो उसमें कहाँ हैदराबाद की कहीं से आए थे तो उनके
नहीं नहीं हम कहीं सुने बातें नहीं ले लेंगे. We have to show, identify evidence. It has to be Daphnia and not Moina. I of course people. Now your question starts happening, like, is there, what is the difference between the two? How do you find them, all that? So I will leave that as an open challenge, and the challenge sustains. I'm going to give a big prize for people who are going to tell which area in India has Daphnia, and which, of course, I'm actually challenging that everywhere you get only Moina. Delhi mein bhi Moina milta hai, aur Mumbai mein bhi Moina milta hai, aur Kerala mein bhi Moina milta hai. A Moina country. Moina country. This is Moina country. Which countries have Daphnia? Let's find out those things. And maybe over a period of time, we'll come to know that the whole world has only Moina.
Okay, so we will move on to the next presentation. We have, Oh, you want to say something also? Badme, we will have the session, Badme. Or you can write to us.
तो सिफ्टेन ने बोला कि एक मोइना 5 to 10 प्रोजनीज देता है और हीना ने बोला 5 to 20. तो इन दोनों के मोइना में कुछ डिफरेंस है क्या, स्पेशल है कोई?
ओके देख सकते
हाँ उबेद
दोनों भी हो सकता है ना. ओके ठीक है. सो ओके सो वी विल सो नेक्स्ट ग्रुप इज व्हाट मस्किटो या लेट हो रहा है क्योंकि बाद में.
जैसे हमने एक्सपेरिमेंट करने के लिए सब बॉटल में 5-5 मोइना लिए हैं, तो ये अभी हमको कंफर्म नहीं है कि मेल और फीमेल हो है कि नहीं है. वो अपने से जनरेट होते. अभी हमारा आगे जो सेटअप लगाने वाले हैं उसमें एक ही मोइना देखेंगे लेके कि वो अकेले खुद प्रजनन करती हैं कि नहीं और कितने करते हैं, क्योंकि यहाँ पर अभी दो सवाल उठे कि उनके ज़्यादा है इनके कैसे कम. तो इसलिए एक लेके ये देखना है कि वो खुद से प्रजनन करती है कि क्या पता वो 5-5 लिए हैं, दोनों के जेंडर अलग हो, मीट मेट किए हो सकते हैं.
ओके सो नेक्स्ट इज उबैद एंड हिज ग्रुप ऑन मस्किटो एंड या मस्किटो मैपिंग.
गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन. वी आर माय सेल्फ रियाना. वी आर फ्रॉम चेंबूर नागा एमपीएस. वी आर कोलैबोरेशन विद Devanar School and STN Javier's College in Kerala, and also with Adarsh Vidyalaya. So the Ubaid is going to tell you the season cycle of mosquito.
So we are doing according to seasonal cycle, because in September, if we got data in September, and then we can compare to March, means autumnal equinox to vernal equinox, because the day and night time are same. And if we got data in winter solstice and summer solstice, then we can compare, because in winter solstice the days are shorter than the night, and in June means summer solstice the day are larger than the night.
So we So we are catching the mosquito by clap trap method. So we first we do by clap trap method, but later on we move to ovitrap method because we find the trapping method is not very effective. Like if we catch by clap trap method, we can prevent the mosquitoes, but it must be have bite someone. But if we when we do by ovitrap method, before the mosquito get adult, we can like destroy them so they cannot reproduce. So the Jubair is going to tell you how to make ovitrap.
Step one, prepare plastic cup, and step two, paint it black because mosquito attract to dark color. And step three, fill the half cup with water. Step four, wrap white cloth on the scale. Step five, label it. Step six, keep it outside and check whether the mosquito has lay eggs or not. I found eggs with ovitrap. ये तीन तरह के मॉस्किटो के डिफरेंस एक्स के डिफरेंसेस है. फर्स्ट एनोफिलीज, सेकंड एडीज एंड थर्ड क्यूलेक्स. हम लोग एडीज पे काम कर रहे हो तो हम लोग एडीज को फाइंड करना है तो वो इस तरह दिखता है. वो अलग अलग होता है और ब्लैक कलर का होता है. और एनोफिलीज बीच में वाइट होता है, साइड में ब्लैक होता है. और क्यूलेक्स जितने भी एक्स है सारे जॉइंट होते.
और हमें एडीज मिला है क्योंकि आप देख सकते हैं इसके साइड में ना कि एक डॉट है और ये अलग अलग कलर है, अलग अलग जगह पे हैं. तो हमने एक हाइपोथेसिस बनाया था जिसमें ये गौरांगी का हाइपोथेसिस है. जो पहले मेरी कलीग थी उसने बोला था कि जनवरी टू मई में नॉन एडीज ज़्यादा होंगे कंपेयर टू एडीज, एंड फ्रॉम मई टू सेप्टेम्बर द नॉन एडीज विल बी लेसर देन द मॉस्किटोज विल बी मोर कंपेयर एंड द एडीज विल बी मोर कंपेयर टू नॉन एडीज बिकॉज इन रेनी सीजन शी थिंक्स दैट द इफ मॉस्किटो विल ले एग्स ऑन द वाटर then when rain comes it will flesh out. And in my hypothesis I used to think that from January to April the number of mosquito will not be more because there will be no water, and from May to September the mosquitoes number will be more because rain will be coming and more water will be collected in nutshell and some old shoes. And in both the cases the similarities was that the Aedes will be more compared to non Aedes, and the results were really different because in I used to think that January to April the total number of mosquitoes will be less, but when I got mosquitoes then the results were different because from January to May the total number of mosquitoes was more compared to Aedes. And how does the ovitrap work? As you all know that mosquito lay eggs on the water, so that's why we fill it with a half of water, and we wrap the scale by white cloth because the mosquitoes eggs are black in color, so that's why we can see it easily. So if we keep outside or near the dark area, mosquitoes will come and lay eggs on the scale there, so we can easily see. So and the benefit is that because we can get the data before the mosquito get adult and before it bites someone. So we got this number of mosquitoes, and one time we got 125 mosquitoes in a day. So it's really good compared to this clap trap, because when mosquito get adult, then we used to trap the mosquito. So in this one we can get before the mosquito get adult. So our future plan is that we will compare the data with the hypothesis that we made again for 1 year, and we will map the mosquitoes trapped by the Ovitrap and differentiate the Aedes and non-Aedes eggs. Thank you. Any questions? Yes. Yes. So we got Aedes more in July. So I can say that in coming July you can get dengue in more number.
So how about March?
You can get, but in less number compared to July. But you can get malaria or elephantiasis more, because we got the non-Aedes number more, like 140. Yes, we can match our data with the BMC data. Yes. Okay. Okay. इधर एडीस के क्योंकि हमें एडीस के ही एग्स मिले थे और नहीं मिले थे, जितने बार भी हमने रखा सिर्फ एडीस के एग्स ही मिले थे हमें.
और दूसरे सीजन्स में आपको ओविट्रैप पे और किसी मॉस्किटो के एग नहीं मिले?
दूसरे हमने इसको बहुत कम टाइम पे रखा है, इसके लिए अभी फ्यूचर में ज़्यादा टाइम रखेंगे, मतलब एवरी डे रखेंगे.
सो आपका फ्यूचर प्लान अभी क्या है? अभी आप हर सीजन में ओविट्रैप्स रखेंगे और जितना एग
शायद से एडीज मिल सकती है, क्योंकि वो एकदम फ्रेश वाटर पे एल एक्स करते, और जो नॉन एडीज है वो थोड़े
गंदे पानी में
गंदे टाइप के रहते
वो लोग. अच्छा, वो गंदे टाइप के रहते. तो आप गंदे टाइप के वाटर में, जहाँ पे पहले से ही गंदे टाइप का वाटर है, वहाँ पे अपना ओवी ट्रैप ले जाके नहीं रख सकते, सिर्फ स्केल और जिसके ऊपर वाइट क्लॉथ हो?
नहीं तो उसमें थोड़ा गंदा पानी रख सकते,
क्या पता आपका गंदा पानी उनको गंदा ना लगे.
तो
जो जो पहले से गंदा है उसमें आप ओवी ट्रैप रख देंगे तो चलेगा?
तो हमें कई बार लार्वेज मिले किसी ड्रम में या, और वो एडीज के नहीं थे, तो उस जगह के आप पानी लेके ट्राई कर सकते हैं.
हाँ, ये भी कर सकते हैं. तो ये आप फ्यूचर प्लान है आपका, करने वाले हैं आप?
फ्यूचर प्लान. मोर क्वेश्चंस?
आपने ये प्रोजेक्ट क्यों लिया?
एक मिनट, क्योंकि जब फर्स्ट टाइम स्कूल से यहाँ लाए गए थे तो हमें हमारी राय नहीं पूछी गई थी और हमें सीधा एक ग्रुप में डाल दिया. और फिर बाद में वो इंटरेस्टिंग लगा, इसके लिए अभी भी उस पे ही है. नहीं, हाँ, और सबसे ज़्यादा डाफनिया में थे क्योंकि उसमें उनके फ्रेंड्स थे और टीचर ने अलाउ किया उनको जाना उधर. नहीं, अभी थोड़े दिन पहले किए थे तो उनको उनके एरिया में एक भी एग्स नहीं मिले थे एडीज के। हाँ नहीं उनके एरिया में हुआ था उनको उन्होंने ही मुझे बताया ओविट्रैप के बारे में। एनी मोर क्वेश्चंस?
किसको मला तो बोल दे।
हाँ तो वो अगर आते तो उसको हम पहले ही मार देते
भैया।
हाँ भैया
आप आइडेंटिफाई कैसे करोगी ये मेल है और फीमेल है?
मतलब हाँ एग्स में नहीं कर सकते उसके लिए उनको एडल्ट होना पड़ेगा।
क्या?
और हम नहीं चाहते कि वो एडल्ट हो। हाँ लेकिन अगर हमें एडल्ट मॉस्किटो मिला तो उसको कर सकते क्योंकि उसके
पर कैसे पता चलेगा?
रुको उनके एंटेनास पे ज्यादा हेयर होते और फीमेल के एंटेनास पे कम हेयर होते। जैसे मेल्स में मुस्टैचेस होते और फीमेल्स को नहीं होते उसमें वैसे ही होता है तो आप देख गूगल पे देख सकते हैं आप।
अगर कोई मॉस्किटो खून पीने आ रहा मतलब वो फीमेल है।
हाँ क्योंकि उसको ब्लड में फाइब्रिनोजेन होता है और उसके हेल्प से वो एग्स ले करते और मेल्स को करना नहीं होता तो वो प्लांट के जूस पे अपना गुजारा करते।
नहीं जो आप बोल रहे थे कि एडीज जो मॉस्किटो है उससे किस तरह की बीमारी हो सकती है?
डेंगू येलो फीवर
यानी कि वो एक ही मच्छर से हो सकती है या कोई और भी मच्छर से और भी कोई बीमारी हो सकती है?
वो एडीज और येलो फीवर एक ही मॉस्किटो से होंगे।
तो डेंगू कौन से मच्छर से होता है?
डेंगू हाँ सॉरी एडीज से होता है।
Arushi had a question ki how can you use mosquito as a model? First of all, there is an ethical issue. We are not supposed to rear mosquitoes, so we can't use mosquito in our labs, at least, you know. Suggest an experiment then.
टू रेयर द मॉस्किटो इज एन एथिकल इशू बट यू कैन यूज द मॉस्किटो टू फीड समबडी एल्स
क्योंकि मयूर भैया के
कुछ एथिकल इशू क्योंकि
मयूर भैया के कुछ स्टूडेंट्स ने उसको फीड करते थे उनको कुछ चिकन्स देते थे
चिकन्स या
हां तो उससे वो जो हैन होते थे उनका नुकसान होता था तो उनको वो प्रोजेक्ट करने से बैन कर दिया। इसके लिए उसको मॉडल ऑर्गेनिज्म के ऐसा नहीं यूज कर सकते। एक मिनट एक और क्वेश्चन।
व्हाट इज ओविट्रैप?
ओविट्रैप दिस इज ओविट्रैप।
ओवि मींस एग्स
एंड ट्रैप मींस ट्रैप
जाल।
जाल
लेकिन कैसे बनाते?
कैसे तो एक तो आप एक कप ले सकते हैं इस टाइप का नहीं तो एक हाफ कटेड बॉटल ले सकते हैं उस पर पेंट कर सकते हैं ब्लैक नहीं तो कोई डार्क कलर उससे मस्किटोज अट्रैक्ट होते हैं और उसमें स्केल पे वाइट क्लोथ रैप कर सकते हैं और रख सकते हैं। वाइट टिश्यू पेपर या पेपर मत लेना क्योंकि उससे वो मिक्स हो जाते हैं पानी में और कुछ मिलेगा नहीं आपको। ऐसा हो चुका है हमारे साथ इसके लिए।
Okay, yeah, so we will wind up the session, the presentation. Okay, so next I will call Abhijit Mitesh and his group to present the work on snails. Snail is a wonderful model system for, as we know, in long time we are using it for learning and memory studies. So they have developed some essays and some kind of, you know, modifications in that experiment. Yeah.
हेलो
मालूम है मुझे इवनिंग है ना
करना.
गुड इवनिंग टू वन एंड ऑल प्रेजेंट ओवर हियर. आई एम ऋत्विक, ही इज रोहित, ही इज अनिकेत एंड ही इज अभिजीत एंड वी आर फ्रॉम आदर्श विद्यालय चेंबूर एंड आवर प्रोजेक्ट इज बेस्ड ऑन स्नेल्स. Our title of the project is A Study to Develop Methods to Change the Behavior Pattern of Snails by Association Conditioning. Abstract: Snails are destructive organisms that are detrimental to human and human concerns. By using harmful chemical pesticides, environment can be affected. Giant African land snails are one of the most dreaded crops raiders in the world. This project is an attempt to develop a method to change the pestiferous giant African land snails into a non-pestiferous by associative conditioning. Our work plan is, the project work timetable was started from 3rd July 2017. Samples selected for observations, the vegetable extract such as cucumber, tomato and cabbage. Vegetables, experimentations and sample animal was giant African land snail. Snail culture was developed in the school laboratory in a closed ventilated basket which was kept in a tray containing water. This prevents the hibernation of the snails by creating a scene like rainy season. Our hypothesis is
pestiferous giant African land snail can be turned into non-pestiferous by associative conditioning. Our objective, immediate objective, to find the food that attracts the snails and to study the response towards it. To compare, the response of snails is more towards samples or in direction in which they are kept. Short-term objective, to find does the canine has any olfactory or not. To study the memory retention period of snails. Long-term objective is to construct a method to change the behavioral pattern of snails by associative conditioning.
So as you can see that we took a circular region paper of 20 centimeter and on it we placed a glass plate. On one side we kept sample and on the other side we kept control. The snail was kept in the middle. We used to change the direction of the snail after every run. And we also kept a tank on it so that we could confirm that there is no other thing which attracts the snail.
Actually, here is a problem that this sample and control is both in a one place only. It is the sample is here and the control is placed on the other side. So it is a.
We also calculated the olfactory responsive index, that is ORI. For control versus control, we use the formula CA minus CB upon CA plus CB. But when sample and control is kept on one side, on both the sides, sorry, we use the formula C minus S upon C plus S.
Now, when we started our project, so we took one snail. Actually, we took many four snails for our test, and one was like control. So here we took a test snail, which was named as interest. We named it as snail's interest. So here we did the experiments like control versus control and ORI was calculated and like that to check that to quinine has any odor or not. So like this we have done. And on based on this table, we have made a graph. And this graph.
What is quinine actually?
Quinine is a additive which we have to. Quinine is an additive which we are using for the means like when we add something in that sample which is cucumber extract. So when we put quinine in that, it is odorless, and it is very bitter in taste. So by this means when the snail go towards the sample, assuming that it's a good smell is coming from it, but it is having a bad taste. So when it tastes it, it is getting. Means with you back. So that is, we have to check that is quinine having some smell or not. So that's why we placed control versus quinine also. Yeah, plus point, the plus shows the attraction, but the it is not should be the ORI should be like attraction and repulsion. It should be also like equal distributions. Means there is like if you...
Your control versus control is also 0.2, or not? If you go back to your thing.
Yeah.
So see the last column, the control versus control, it's also 0.2. So it's like same as control versus
quinine. So I would like to, so like this circular region we have used. So here we can see that when control is kept on both the sides, means let's assume that here also control is there and here also control is there, means there is no odor in the in this particular region, and we have placed it. So it is water, distilled water. Distilled water we are using as a control. So when control is placed, there not only the ORI should become zero, but it should have an equal distribution. Means there is no smell, so it can go anywhere it wants to. So it's also like a, so it was like a equal distribution only. Yeah, the figure was not going. That's why we put like this diagram type of thing. Yeah, but photograph was not going. Some technical problem was there. Yeah.
ORI 0. And the last one is also control versus control, ORI plus 0.2. Why do you put like that? What is this? Why did you do again control versus control, ORI, which is very different from 0?
Yep. We started with control versus control. So we have to check that in last also, that there is a experimental setup is good till the last we did, till the last experiment.
What is that? Could you just explain that? It's not very clear.
So,
is it only once you did it that you got zero? The control versus control, that left side.
No.
Versus control, once you did it and you got an ORI of zero. Then you did control versus quinine, you got a ORI of plus two. Is it once? Is it a reading?
No. With each snail, we did it 20 times.
So then there should be a mean and a standard deviation or something.
Yeah.
Only one trial.
Yeah.
Sorry.
One
set of
20 runs of one set is of 20 runs.
So only once you have run the snail.
Yes.
20 times.
Yeah.
And the reading is the 20 times when you ran it, in order to get zero, you should get 10 intercepts one side and 10
intercepts
other
side.
And that's all you got.
Yes.
That's next time if you did it, you would have got 0.5 plus 0.5. How will you roll out that possibility? You do it once and then say that's the fact. That's not real.
Yeah. Four snails.
So this is a particular snail called interest, is it?
Yeah.
Okay. So you did control versus control. You got zero.
Zero.
And here you got plus 0.2. If you did it, so twice you did it, control versus control.
Yeah.
So if you did it 5 times, you would have got probably not zero. You would have got 0.4.
Something like that.
So how many times you did it, and how many times, if you did it only once, how many times you should be doing it in order for you to get convinced about it?
After each experiment, where first we started with control versus control.
Yes.
Then we did control versus quinine. And again we should do control versus.
No. Control versus control itself, you should have been doing 5 or 6 times and then taken an average of that.
Okay.
Why didn't you tested all your 4 snails?
Yes.
We have tested, but here we have means
this
snail
has showed most promising results.
Yeah, that's
like what you wanted. This snail goes according to you. Other snails, what, like they contradicted interest, your interest?
No, it was something nearby this only, means what we expect.
So if you have put that like one interest, one non-interest, maybe interest, so all those 4 snails and you do for all 5 times, so you will get a bigger data set from which you can like easily, more convincing, you can find the standard deviation in the mean, right?
See, this is looking as if you have taken a convenient
Yeah, we have, but the logbook is in school.
Do you have any idea?
No.
Yeah, I have idea of two snails. They were having when first time we did. It was like this is interest, so we got zero. And there's another snail called as. This interest. So it was giving the ORI something like plus 0.1, mm-hmm. And some was yeah. Then. It should be like equal distribution and the.
No, what's the data? ORI, you have to tell us that.
Zero to zero.
Near to zero.
What even better? Near to zero.
Means minus.
B plus 2 is plus point what 2 is near to zero.
So ideally, if you put control and control on both the sides, what do you expect normally from a snail? Like all the snails you test. You hypothesize that the snail cannot differentiate between water and water, right?
Mm.
It should not show any preferential towards water versus water. It should be like, that's why it's zero, right? It's not going anywhere else repeatedly. Mm. So that you can only find out if you test all the four snails 5 times each. So you get 5 for the 20 points, that 20 times I run different snails and they move towards this or that thing. Same thing is with Q9 and your sample which you are putting. If a snail, if you run only once and the snail is going, by chance it is going towards your Q9 or your sample, you will see that the ORI is 0.9, and I am very sure that this is the hypothesis. So might be it's wrong, right? By chance it got there. But four snails each running 5 times, then it cannot be by chance, right? Every time it cannot move that side by chance.
Yep. So according to that, we have made a graph of the snail interest again. So here, first we did control versus control, so it was like zero. And then when we did control versus quinine, that is you have to check that is quinine having some odor or not. So we did, so it was get 0.2. And then we did control versus sample. So control versus sample was a cucumber extract. We used cucumber extract for this test. And then it shows the plus 0.7. And then we did in the next run, we took sample and we added quinine before doing the experiment. We took a glass slide and on that we mixed cucumber extract plus quinine. And in that, we ran the snail on the slide and it went towards the cucumber extract and it tasted it. And after that, when it went back to the shell, and after that we did the experiment. So we got the ORI which was minus 0.4, minus 0.5, sorry. So this is a very good thing which we expected.
Yeah, so from control versus sample and control versus sample plus quinine.
Yeah.
So the difference is in control versus sample plus quinine, you are actually letting the snail expose to this thing first, then you are taking the reading,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah.
So because once it's exposed and it knows it has a bitter taste, now it will go or not.
Yeah.
Right. So what time frame you are selecting is like so after exposure, immediately you are doing it?
No, after 15 minutes something.
So after 15 minutes, so like you hypothesize that after 15 minutes also the snail
15, 1-5.
So after 15 minutes also the snail knows that this side is having sample plus quinine. I should not go there.
We assume like that.
Okay. And for the sample, you let the snail expose for the first time, then you took the reading?
No, that we did directly.
Then how it makes sense? See, for the samples, the snail was not knowing what is there. So you didn't let the snail taste it. And then, because if you are adding quinine, what is your hypothesis? That quinine is having some odor or not?
Yeah.
Okay. But because the graph goes negative, because they are saying that when they tested with sample plus quinine, they first let the snail taste it, it's bitter, and then they run. Yeah, they did the assay. Huh. No. They already mix sample with quinine.
Yeah.
And they let the snail taste it. Obviously, the snail will taste a bitter thing. Then after 15 minutes, they are running this control versus this mixture assay.
Yes.
Yeah. And if you are doing that, why didn't you do that with your control versus sample? Because for sample also, let the snail first taste it. Then after 15 minutes, you should do. You should keep the methodology same. Otherwise, in one case, you have not let the snail taste the sample. So it's only sample control.
Yes.
And you are taking reading.
Yeah.
On the other hand, when you are putting Q9, you are letting it taste it, and then you are taking the reading. So what?
Yeah. So we did like this because if we did directly control versus quinine, so first time in the first run, suppose we are taking 20 runs. So in the first run, it will go definitely towards the sample because it's not experienced that thing.
I'm not saying sample versus quinine. Do.
Point 0.7.
You have not run anywhere sample versus quinine. Have you run sample versus Q9? At one side only Q9, at one side only sample? Have you done that?
No, like that we didn't.
Okay. Nowhere sample versus Q9.
This control versus Q9.
So, when you have done control versus sample plus Q9, what I am saying is, don't make the snail taste the mixture first. And then only put control at one side and sample versus Q9 on other side and see what happens, like you did for control versus sample. I'm asking why you exposed the snail in the first place to this mixture before taking the reading. What was the thinking behind that?
Since we think that in the first ones, the snail will go towards the sample and that it will experience the bitter taste of the quinine with the sample, and then it will start repelling towards the sample. It will start repulsion towards the sample from the second run.
You should have done a sample at one side, cucumber extract. Put cucumber extract at one side and quinine alone at other side. Then you can, what you can see, if it goes first time towards the Q9 and tastes it, it's bitter. Next time it is always going towards the sample or not. This will suggest that, okay, it got a taste of a bitter quinine, so it's always going now towards the sample. But here your sample and quinine is mixed, right? And once you are pre-exposing it to it before taking the reading, from next time it will always go towards control. Is it not happening?
No.
From next time it's always going towards control, that's why it's coming negative, right?
Okay, what is the next one that you're trying? Control versus
that is control versus sample after the... So after one day. Yeah.
One second, Rahul. You suggested that we do sample versus quinine, right? But quinine is odorless. So if you do
quinine is odorless, why they are getting 0.2? He wants to prove that only, na? See, in control versus quinine, they are getting 0.2. If it is odorless, it should be zero. Both the things are odorless, it should be zero, right? Yeah. But it's getting plus 0.2.
Mm.
And they are like on that.
Yeah, if we could tell the number of intercepts, then we could say that if it is significant or insignificant.
That's what I'm saying, with all the four snails, run it 5 times each snail.
Yeah.
Then you can like.
Control versus sample again.
It's not again. You did do a control versus sample with the immediately after treating with the quinine.
Because the snail was in starvation periods. Because so before doing all these experiments, like control versus control sample, we starved the snails for 18 hours. So means like if we are not hungry, then why will should respond to the suppose biryani given to us?
What he is asking is, you starve the snail for 18 hours.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, when you are starting your experiment, you should probably make six this assay boxes or slides what you have, like six arenas, one with control versus control, control versus quinine, control versus sample, control versus mixture of sample and quinine, then again control versus sample, And if possible, sample versus quinine you can also test. But the time period in which you are doing each assay, the in-between time period should be fixed. Like for from going from second to third, you are taking 15 minutes of gap. From mixture to again control versus sample, you are taking 1 day of gap. So why is it? You are again starving it?
Yeah. So it again goes to the, it again shows the attraction towards the sample. That is, means it's showing, giving the ORI plus 0.4.
What do you mean by that?
So it is going towards, uska memory chala gaya, matlab, uska memory chala gaya, ki dek, means he get a experience on sample versus control plus control versus sample plus quinine that it is having a bad taste. But
okay, so you think that memory has
changed. Yeah.
So it doesn't remember that of tasting the quinine with the samples the second time, right? So did you continue to next day after 24 hours did you do that?
No.
Because your data suggests both the things. See, first control versus sample. Look at your slide. The first time you put control versus sample, what is the ORI?
It's plus
0.7.
Yeah.
You let it taste the bitter thing, sample versus quinine. Now, next day, again control versus sample. But next day. But look at the ORI. It's not 0.7 again.
Yeah, it is reduced.
So if it has forgotten the bitter taste, why the ORI has reduced?
So maybe one time he went to the sample side and he get a new memory that.
But next time there is no quinine to remember, right?
Yeah.
So maybe it has not forgotten in one day. Okay, maybe because your numbers are very less. So that's why we cannot conclude. So yeah. So if you do it like what we have suggested with all the four snails and multiple times, you can get to a better data and better graph. The design is good, you need to make some changes and you need to increase the N because the question is very good. Question is good, design is not good.
This was the summary of the graph. So the control versus control shows that aroma was the setup was aroma free.
But you still think so?
No.
After all this discussion?
No.
So what do you want to conclude? Let us just conclude, not meaning the whole thing, but just conclude now from the discussion that has taken place.
In the conclusion, you can tell your future plans.
Yes.
What
are you happy
plans?
About it? Are you?
No, we are not happy. Yeah.
See, the whole list doesn't stand anywhere now, is it not? Because you don't have numbers.
Yeah. So conclusion was
you have to do the experiment and find out.
Yeah.
We will be moving to next presentation that is of Cardamine that is by Preeti and Arjun. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, and Abhijit. Who? Okay, Abhijit. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Arjun Jaiswani from Bombay College of Pharmacy. This is Preeti, and this is Abhijit. And we are going to present about a plant which is called as cardamine. Cardamine now is a very simple and small plant which can grow anywhere and is easily available. So cardamine is a small plant which is easily available throughout the country, and it can be easily grown in favorable conditions. As we can see in the PPT, it's quite easily grown, and as it says, it's a tabletop farm, and it can be grown in labs, houses, or anywhere. It's easily grown. Now coming to why cardamine. Cardamine basically looks like a simple plant, but it is not so. It has a very complex structure, and its anatomy and morphology is quite different and compared to other plants. As we can see, the parts of the flower and the bud are very complicated. It has a stamen, an ovary, a piston, and hence it is so complex in its development. Hence we study cardamine.
Excuse me for a minute.
There's a problem in the images. Arabidopsis thaliana is a relative of cardamine hirsuta, and has a lot of differences between them, but belongs to the same family. There are quite a few differences between them. Arabidopsis thaliana, the leaf shape is simple, whereas cardamine, it's compound. There are 6 stamens in Arabidopsis, while 4 in cardamine. There are 4 petals, while in cardamine it ranges from 0 to 4. The pod shatter pattern ranges from is non-explosive in Arabidopsis, while in cardamine it's explosive. The seed shape is oblong in Arabidopsis, while in cardamine it's disc-shaped. And the seed surface is bumpy in Arabidopsis, while in cardamine it's got indented dimples.
By using cardamine, we can have different types of studies. Like you can see here, we have made like this flowchart was made last year during March model March meet. So using cardamine, we can study what is the life cycle and how it varies the physiology according to the place to place. What is the pollen variability, organ size if it's differing, if the amount of time required to form one organ
and to develop into the next organ is same or different in different conditions. The flowering time for seed production, then depending on what is the photo period, how does it affect the plant, depending on different growth conditions like ecology, soil, water, temperature, humidity, how the plant is differing. And it becomes more easier to generate because this plant requires only 60 days, approximately 60 days to from seed to seed. So this becomes easier to do replicate studies in 1 year. We can also study different types of conditions, like what if you have different types of soil. So how it is affecting the plant, and the question which we were and also the embryology and stuff we were interested in is gene transfer. Like what we were interested in is we wanted to perform the gene transfer from one plant to like in cardamine, like by a simple method called as floral dip method. So what we can do is we take that gene, like this is what was our long-term objective, and then we transfer it via agrobacterium into the plant using a marker gene. I will describe a little detail about it in next slides. This is a work done by Angela Hay et al. They are from Max Planck Institute, Germany. They have been working on cardamine as a model since a long time. They have done a comparative studies between Arabidopsis and cardamine. And out of this, we are interested mainly in the flower, since it will be used in the floral dip method. So Arabidopsis flower, we can see that it has 4 petals. Cardamine, it can have 0 to 4 petals. It's variable. I'm extremely sorry. There are some few images which are missing because of some technical error. This is a cardamine. This is a cardamine, and this is the Arabidopsis cultivated by Shruti from NCBS. This is a pic from cardamine from Ranchi. Benita, another cubist who was working on it. Sorry for a missing image. This is the cardamine from which was done 2-3 years back by Dale Rodericks, and here were 2 pics of cardamine from Manipur, which is on the near Assam, and this is from Cube Mumbai. Like it's missing. I'm sorry. What was our immediate objective? The immediate objective was to understand what is the life cycle of our cardamine. So that if we know it, then only we can perform some experiment on it. So we started with culturing of cardamine. So to understand morphology, and once we started with understanding what is the life cycle, first we because the cardamine has a compound leaf, it means that it's if you see this, it has got this whole thing is a leaf. And it has got 3 leaflets, 1, 2, and 3 leaflets. So this is called a compound leaf. So how it is got a compound leaf, and so here you can see there are 3 compound leaflets, 3 leaflets. This it has got 7 leaflets. So the number of leaflets is also variable. So we started with counting how much leaflets it has with like the first leaf, second leaf, how much leaflets it has. Then we went to understand what is the morphology and anatomy of a flower, and what are the different stages of flower development with respect to time, how much time it requires from a green bud to a whole flower and then to a mature pod. The reason behind this is our short-term objective was to perform floral dip for gene transfer using some marker gene. Like if we have to understand whether the gene transfer has taken place or not, we need to have some signal. That signal can be any antibiotic resistant gene, like for example kanamycin, which we will add along with our whatever agrobacterium gene, the gene in the agrobacterium. And when if the genes is transferred, we can select those seeds which are gene transformed, whereas we will not select those seeds which are not in which the gene transfer has not taken place. And the long term objective was to carry out gene transfer for altering the leaf shape of cardamine. I'm sorry for the missing image. We were interested in different stages of flower development. So this is the green floral bud with green sepals. You can see this was a leaf, and here a new leaf is getting initiated. Along with it, you can see there's a green bud, a bud with a green sepals. The bud now it was earlier only green in color, but you can see at the tip there is a little whitish part. So here actually there was an image which was which was actually a green bud with white sepals in between. Now here we can see the white petals will become more prominent. One second. Just show you the image of a flower. I'm sorry for the inconvenience. Okay, there actually here we had a very beautiful image of a cardamine flower. And when it's bloomed, how it looks with its stigma at the bottom and how its anther are protruding, like four anthers. This is the next stage where the stigma has now already come up. The anthers would be below it. So the stigma has started coming up. Now it is developing into a pod. So this, you can see the stigma along with like it's growing, and we can see stigma at the top. So this ovary is developing into a pod. Further, we can see how it is elongating. And earlier we had green sepals, which are looking prominent, and also the white petals. Then we can see the green sepals are not there, they are absent. We can see only white petals are present. This is an image where we can see the pod is almost like maturing and the white petals have loosened up. Here the white petals have disappeared. Like this is the inflorescence, how a cardamine, it is called the racemose inflorescence, where the older flowers will be at the base and the younger ones are at the top. So after this pod is matured, you just need to touch it. So if you touch it, it will burst open, and this is how the seeds look. There was a video of how to collect the seeds. I'm sorry, it won't be able to play. Now, what inspired us to take up this long-term objective was the work done by Angela et al. What they had done was they took this cardamine and they had this Arabidopsis. Arabidopsis has a simple leaf. You can see it's only one leaf. And cardamine, it has different leaflets, so it's a compound leaf. So they introduced this RCO gene into cardamine because of they introduced this gene in this, because of which it started developing a little bit like a simple leaf. And they inhibited one gene in this Arabidopsis, because of which it is becoming a little curved shape, similar to what is happening in compound leaf, but not exactly, because it's not only one gene which is playing a role in formation of a leaf shape. The summary will be told by Abhijit.
From all the observations, we could see that plant take an average to 6 days to develop a new leaf. It means that average 6 days it take to develop a new leaf. Generally, the leaf pattern which we observe is that we expect the leaf pattern should be like 1-1, 3-3, 5-5, and 7-7, like this. But there can be variations in this. Bud is generally observed with the initiation of seventh leaf. That is an average on 6 weeks post germination. Type of inflorescence is racemose. Current hypothesis will be explained by Preeti.
Whatever the number of samples we have taken, accordingly we could see that the time taken from a green bud with a green sepals to a fully bloomed flower is 2 days. But we didn't have the enough number of observations, and also we didn't because of our not proper follow-up, we couldn't observe it properly for one plant, the whole development from a bud to a whole mature pod. So whatever pictures we shown, it was like captured at different stages of different flowers. So we need to do a proper follow-up, then only we can say with confirmation that yes, bud to flower takes only 2 days. And for flower to mature, from becoming a fully bloomed flower to mature pod, it requires approximately 10 to 12 days, which needs to be validated with appropriate number of samples. The learning outcome is that this is a very easily available plant model to study plant morphology. Like whenever we study in textbooks how a plant develops, like flower develops into fruit, we just have it given, okay, there's a flower, it there's this pollination takes place and then it develops into a fruit. But you can actually observe it within a short span of time, so it is a very good model to show it in schools and colleges. It is a good model for carrying out molecular biology experiments at a college level, like as we said, gene transfer using floral dip method. The goof ups, we made many goof ups. Like we didn't write proper details in logbooks. Like we didn't mention what is the watering regimen. So if I'm having a certain kind of, I'm watering some amount for some for the plants, it won't be followed by all my team members. So then we came to know, okay, we don't have the same idea what should be the watering regimen. Then we had a causery and then we designed how our watering regimen should be for each type of cultures. Like we can see, we have tray cultures. Also we had some lawn cultures near G6 lab. So each thing needs to be devised, how what it should be watered. So even if any one of us is not present, our cultures would be taken care of by someone else. So that was one thing. Then while writing in lab record book, we used to just mention all the details. We used to just write, okay, this many number of leaves, bud, flower, everything. But what is the takeaway message from the whole page? This way our whole logbook is getting filled. But what is the takeaway important message from that whole page? If somebody just picks up our logbook, how will they come to know, okay, what is the most important thing to look for in this page? So we should at least make that important highlight point with some other color. We should have a remark column where we should write what is the important thing in the whole page. The people will only look into that. Then we need to, like, we were not initially interested in knowing the whole anatomy of a of our plant. We were like interested, okay, chalo, we have our long-term objective, we should focus only on that. But no, then we had, during causery, sir and everyone, like, when they we discussed, we got to know before we step into anything like our short-term or long-term objective, first important step is knowing our organism. If we don't know our organism, we cannot step into the further plans. Then if we have a design, like we have to plan everything a day prior to it. If we have designed it, then we should start post it on the groups or emails and then discuss with others. So they may point out, okay, this is a problem in your design. Like in the snail group, they had a certain design, but then somebody said, okay, you need to do number of replicates need to be there. This is supposed to be amended. So when you discuss, that time you start understanding how you should design it properly and your design gets optimized. So that we started learning during this project. Number of replicates, like earlier we just had one tray, like this is our tray A, which we started with. And I thought it is enough. We have many plants. But then what if the tray gets damaged, somehow something happens and it is damaged, then my whole culture is lost. So we should not just have one replicate. We should have n number of replicates, not just at one place, but at different places as well. We should be a good observer and we should report whatever are our findings with good photos. And considering the audience, we should label the what should be looked in the photos. And but the most important thing is following up. Do you have any questions,
Preeti? How this plant can be linked to codominance? Because the leaves are showing two dimorphic shapes at a time. So can this I don't know, but can this be linked to codominance?
Is it always only two at a time? Like two types of leaves are there in one plant? Because I saw more than two. Like if you go to the picture.
Yeah, we have one leaflet stage, three leaflet, four leaflet.
In the same plant.
Five leaflet and seven leaflet stage.
In the same plant, right?
Yeah.
Then it's
yes.
Not codominance because
It's just the compound leaf. It's not a different type of leaf in the same plant.
Like it could be there, but we have no idea about it. Like.
why don't you go to the picture back? Like, if
it has different number of leaflets, okay, but it is actually a compound leaf only.
The shape is also different. Like, if you observe it for the first initial two leaves, which are one and one leaflet leaves, it is the leaflet shape is quite different as compared to the leaves which will come later for seven leaflet stage. I'm sorry, I couldn't show you the picture of a fully grown plant.
So
like,
can you explain that?
Yeah. That answers what she's asking. See, over there.
Like, here we can see we have five leaflets. Instead of that, if we have only one leaflet, so that time it will be only one broad leaf. Then when it has three leaves, we can see a leaf is similar to this, and we have two leaflets. And as and when its leaflets start increasing, like in this picture, that is the gene responsible for this leaf shape, the compound leaf shape. And like, if you see in the seven leaflet stage, like here, we can see the leaf shape is quite different as compared to this. This is a broader leaf which is at the base, but the upper leaf, as it the stem grows up, the upper leaves which are having more number of leaflets, it is becoming more narrower.
Is it like there is a differential gene expression as the plant grows towards, like, from the basal to the...
Yes, could be possible. Means regarding differential... like what we observed for our sample, almost similar, yes. But for literature studies, we didn't look into this detail. Yeah, in this, like, we can see we have this five leaflet stage. Now here, it is almost like. What they did was they mutated this gene in cardamine. So, like, they must have carried out some either a gene transfer or some mutation, and because of which the leaf shape has altered. Yeah.
Are you?
Yeah, they have done some.
Okay. Because we have a little bit only now. Abhi ek ghante mein ho jayega.
Yeah, we had read.
So agar aap ruk sakte to ho jayega pura.
Yeah, they had done like in I don't exactly recall which paper it was.
Yeah, I will.
They have also performed some similar gene transfer.
Yeah, are you sure about it? And otherwise, let's not waste our time.
Yeah,
yes.
Because
sure
we have less time. Yeah, you can look at the things which he said, that, you know, whether the leaves differentiation increases if it grows. Yeah.
In their own setup.
In their own setup, you can.
Regarding differential gene expression,
you may not have the answer now, but you should be looking for.
This question.
Okay, so I think we should proceed for the next present, that is of Shreyas.
and he will be presenting on, we know the Pagalapos thing, and he has worked on rotifers specifically. So he'll be talking about the rotifers and some, yeah.
Hi, good evening everyone. I have worked on Pagalapos, and as I mentioned here, life at your doorstep. Now, this particular line, life at your doorstep, is very, very important, because when you look at this word Pagalapos, it won't make any sense if you have heard it for the first time. Basically, it comes from this famous islands, that is Galapagos Islands. Now, as we have been talking since the morning about Darwin, so Darwin was the person who visited Galapagos Island, and he studied evolution by looking at the finches. Finch is a bird who used to, like, finches were there on the Galapagos Island. Now, in this Galapagos Island, you can see it is not just one single island, but it is a series of islands. And you can see there is a land over here surrounded by water. Now, why we call this something like this? How can this be connected? So it is very simple. Here it is land and surrounded by water all over. Here in these two small holes, the sewer lead, the two small holes of the sewer lead, they have water filled up in them most of the time of the year, and there is land all around. So it is just an exact replica of it. So what Darwin actually did at this Galapagos Island? So you can see these are the finches which were there on the Galapagos Island. On different island, there were different kinds of finches. So, like, suppose, let's consider island number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Okay, so in an island, there were finches like this. And when Darwin observed, like, what is the vegetation over here? So he found that mostly there were plants which were having a lot of leaves. And he said that maybe these finches are eating leaves. He went to another island and he saw a slight difference in the shape of the beak. A slight difference. Okay, and you can see that this kind of beak will help the finch eat the seeds. Same, you can see these are for the birds and fruits. These are for grubs. These are for, these are for insects. So, what is the importance? Okay, we see in our everyday life, we see there are differences between the animals, between the birds, but we don't pay attention to it. But the important thing over here was that all of these were the same bird, they were the finches, but they were showing difference in the shape of the beak. And how did that particular population of finches increased on that particular island? So that is how the natural selection works. Like the finches which were the most fit to survive on that particular island with that kind of food, were in abundance on that particular island. And that is how we also want. Now, if we want to study evolution just like this, we don't have resources to go to the Galapagos Island, we don't even need it. Okay, we don't even need to visit such far away places. We can just go out on our footpaths and just have a look at this sewer leads, and these are pretty much just like our Galapagos Islands. Just the only thing is that you won't be able to see big animals and finches, but you'll have to see small microorganisms and study the same evolution. Now, while as we saw the Galapagos Island, the person, Darwin, he chose islands having different kind of vegetations. Okay, now in Pagalapos, we will choose different kinds of wells. Now, I have termed it as wet, semi-wet, and dry. Let me just brief what will be wet, semi-wet, and dry. Many times we make a confusion. Wet will be that which stays wet throughout the year. Okay, not just in the rainy season, but throughout the year. It means that it should be near some leaking tap or some fountain or something like that. The semi-wet should be the one where it usually gets wet and dry, or we can also call it ephemeral, which is constantly changing. So it can be somewhere near a garden where the gardener every day waters in the morning, but by the afternoon it again gets dried up. But the next morning, again it will get wet because the gardener will do his routine work. And the next one will be dry. The dry will be the one which will be dry for long time, and I would prefer to say, or if you can find such well, which will not even get during the monsoon, which will be some under some shade or under like there are tea stalls or something, and under that you can find such kind of wells. So method to collect the sample, how are we going to collect samples? I am extremely sorry for not having the photographs, that's a huge goof up of me. To collect the samples, we just need simple tools like droppers. We need sterile water, sterile test tube, cotton plugs, and logbooks. Why sterile? Because we want the samples only from those wells. We don't want any microbial load from our water, the DC water which we will take. We don't want anything from it. So sterile water. Sterile means just simply pressure cook it. And when we are taking the observation, some things which we should consider, which are very important, are the time of observation. We should note down at what time we are taking the observation, because when we take the dry sample, we can't just observe the dry sample under the microscope. We obviously add some sterile water to the sample and then observe it. So when you look at such sample, it is very crucial to note down the time, because at 0 hours, there sometimes the microorganism won't be present, but after 24 hours or 48 hours, some microorganisms would just emerge, and it is not just jadoo, but they are just coming out of the dormant stage. The next thing is magnification is very important, so that we can know the size of the organism and it becomes easy for us to recognize, to identify which organism it is, and size of the sample to observe. It is very necessary that you don't always observe just one drop of one sample, but we take multiple drops. That is what we are saying since morning, duplicates, triplicates. That is how. So you should determine that what size of sample you should use. I prefer 3 drops of every test tube to observe. Now, when I did this, I observed many different organisms. I was able to identify these many. There were many others which I couldn't identify. So amoeba was there, Volticella was there. There were many diatoms. There were rotifers and there were paramecium. These are some of the poor images, but I hope you can make out. These are rotifers over here. This is again a rotifer over here. He's just exiting the anterior part is out. And over here, if you can see, this is a Volticella. This over here it's flagella, and this is its body. So while working on the Pagalapos, as I told you, I came about all of these many organisms, and I further went ahead to study about rotifer. Now, as you can see, it's Diloid rotifer. Diloid is just the class of that rotifer, and I have said it is a model for HGT, that is horizontal gene transfer. Now, a very simple question: can an organism survive without sexual reproduction? That is, without any kind of variation over a long span, as long as 80 million years, because the last fossil, like the oldest fossil found of Diloids, is 80 million years old. So obviously, many of you would say that it's not very feasible. It won't agree with the theory of evolution which we have. Why that? Okay, so if there is no variation in an organism, all of them would be the same, there won't be any difference. So because of that, if there is any chemical compound coming which is a poison to them, or any change in the environment which is not feasible for them, not suitable for them, all of the population will die at once. But when there is variation happening in the population, some of them will get the ability to survive that kind of maybe climate change, or as I'm saying, a toxic chemical maybe. So at least few of them will survive, and then when the few of them will reproduce, then the population will again be surviving. That is what we call natural selection.
But the question is, has their habitat changed over this 80 million years significantly? Like, they were aquatic, they are still aquatic?
Yes.
So has the environment changed?
Sorry, I couldn't get you. Like
why is adaptation required to deal with the changes to deal with the changes which are happening around us.
Exactly.
If the environment is constant and favorable for a longer period of time.
We can't say for this many long years the environment hasn't changed at all. Even if you are taking just the aquatic environment, as you said, they are living in. So these rotifers are found almost in every plant body which we see in the lakes, in the rivers. And I can't, even we would agree on this particular point that a river 50 years back and river today is not the same if we consider all the chemicals in it. Yeah. So there has been many changes even if they are still aquatic. So, but they are surviving. This rotifer is surviving. So how? There is one answer, that is horizontal gene transfer. Now, let me just brief you up what is diploid, how is a diploid rotifer, and I will move ahead how HGT happens in this. So obviously it is a kingdom Animalia. It's a heterotroph, it's a multicellular. Its phylum is Rotifera. Now, many of us have not heard of this phylum, but yeah, it's a phylum. And how we identify the phylum as Rotifera, this small corona of cilia, this rotating cilia. So whichever organism bears this, it is under the phylum Rotifera. And this is the class Diloidea. I'm extremely sorry again for the images. I will put forward on the WhatsApp groups. This is just, you can easily make it out by the shape. The other two classes are Cycnoidea, which is marine, so don't even think that it can be Cycnoidea. And the other one is Monogonata. It is a freshwater, but it doesn't resemble at all with the shape. It is much more circular, whereas you can see it is much more elongated. So why I'm talking about diploid? Because these diploids are the only one which are asexual since this long time. And the other class, which was Monogonata, they are not exclusively asexual. They become sexual at times. And the size is around 100 to 200 micrometers. It means we can see it with our naked eye. By that, I mean you can't see the image properly. You can't make out the shape, but you can just see it like a dot in your bottle or in your culture. It can be in a tank. It can be in anything. I have it in bottle, in a tank as well in the lab. And it's a freshwater organism. Now my objective is, the long-term objective is to understand the mechanism for HGT in diploid rotifers. The short-term is to transfer the gene of my own interest into a diploid rotifer. And immediate objective is to determine the concentration and type of antibiotics sensitive to diploids. Now why I'm talking about antibiotics, I will come back to it in few moments. So now my hypothesis regarding the horizontal gene transfer, how horizontal gene transfer takes place. Now my hypothesis is based on, there is a group of researchers, Iris and group, they have published it in BMC, Biology, and it is based something on them. So according to that, the undigested DNA from the food of diploid, so whatever diploid will eat, and the when it will eat bacteria or maybe algae, there will be the DNA of that bacteria, that algae, and this rotifers get into the dormant stage on desiccation. That is a very important point, that they, whenever the environment desiccates around them, they go into a dormant stage. That dormant stage is termed as TUN, T-U-N, TUN. Okay, so that is a very important stage. So whenever they go into the dormant stage, at that time there will be some part of the DNA of the bacteria, of the algae, which will be undigested, which means that DNA part will not be broken. So during that time when the rotifer shrinks, the food is over here, the food is in the stomach. If you can see, this is the stomach and these are the ovaries of the rotifer. Okay. Okay. Am I confusing you?
No, I didn't understand going on starvation.
Not starvation. I'm saying into a dormant stage because of desiccation.
Okay.
The water has dried up around it, so it has to go into a dormant stage. Okay. So while going into the dormant stage, it will shrink its body. It will slow down its metabolism. So during that time, whatever food will be there in its stomach. It is not necessary that all of the food will be undigested or all will be digested. There can be some part which is digested, some is undigested. So the undigested DNA, which means the DNA which is not broken of the food, of the bacteria which it has eaten, of the bacterial DNA which is still not broken down, that DNA will go and get... I'm sorry. It will go and fuse with its own genome in its ovaries. Okay, which are just beside the stomach. With the progeny genome, obviously, how can it fuse with the all the cells? Okay, so after that, when the rotifer will again rehydrate, means whenever the conditions will become favorable, when again the water will be available in the surrounding, at that time the rotifer will again rehydrate, it will again move around. At that time, again the cell membranes will close, and by that time the bacterial DNA is now fused with the rotifer's DNA. Okay, so now the progeny which is born, it won't be same as its parents, but it will be different.
Not all progenies, right?
Not all progenies, maybe we can look at it, but we haven't looked at it yet.
Because it must be having like the alien DNA, which is the bacterial DNA which is there.
Yeah.
It must be like only few in numbers as compared to the eggs that which are there in the ovary, right? So one DNA fragment.
We can't be pretty sure that it can be very less or very more, because we don't know if when while going to the desiccating state, the rotifer has just fed or it has eaten a long time ago.
But is there any criteria that one fragment will go to each of the eggs?
No. Very little about this is known. The initial study which was done by Michelson in Harvard University in 2008, they have done some bioinformatic assay, and because of that they say that it is massive horizontal gene transfer, because while comparing they saw that most of the genome of the rotifer was belonging from the bacterial class and all such things. So very little about this is known.
It is pretty interesting then, over 80 million years of lifespan, it is still a rotifer while incorporating so much of DNA from other organisms. Why it's still a rotifer?
Because you are talking about the evolution. No?
Yeah. Okay. So, okay, this has got a bit distorted because it was in a Windows and now we are on Linux. Okay, so how did I isolate the diploids from the Pagalapos sample which I got? I used two different methods. Initially, I used the serial dilution method when I was along with Himanshu doing it. Himanshu is also from Elphinstone College. So we used a micro titer plate, the 96 well plate which we have. And in the first plate, we put the 3 drops of the sample without looking anything under it, because once we made sure that every drop which we are taking under the microscope is having rotifers in it, is having a lot of diploids in it, we just took randomly one drop in the first well of the 96 well plate, and we just did serial dilution. We used to take one drop in the 96, we just used to take one drop from the adjacent plate and add other 2 drops of sterile water. And in the same way, we just did serial dilution. And after 10 such dilutions, we observed it under a microscope to see if there is one single rotifer present. And once we got one single rotifer present, initially we believed that, okay, we have got a single line culture. But after, as we all know, the causeries in the cube lab, I got to know that, okay, maybe there are some eggs coming along with it, which I might have missed. And this is not enough to be called a single line culture. Then along with the help of Arif is an expert looking at very minute things with the naked eyes. So he was the one who said that, okay, I can just see one rotifer in a dropper and I can help you. So along with his help, he helped me to pick up one single rotifer from my culture into a 24 well plate. And as you can see, just one single rotifer means hardly a drop. And one drop of rotifer culture, so just one single rotifer, and I diluted it with around 2 ml of sterile water. And such way I made 5 dilutions, and thus I made sure that when it comes into the last well, I wouldn't call it serial dilution, but I would call it washing my rotifer, so that all the eggs of the rotifer come out or stay in the initial wells. And when it was in the fifth well, it was pretty much sure that it doesn't have any eggs in it, and now it can be called a single line culture. And after that, I was just feeding it with, again, the same Moina method, filled it with milk because it needs bacteria. But now, as it was just one single rotifer in a 24 well plate, I can't feed it with a large amount of milk. So simple thing, I just took 500 ml water, sterile water, I added one drop of milk to it to make it the same concentration, and of this solution, I added one drop to the 24 well plate, and that is how the culture increased in a 24 well plate initially, then in a test tube, from a test tube to the bottle, from bottle to the tank. So this is just how our media works. The milk, it will lead to growth of bacteria, and that bacteria will be the feed for our rotifers. So now, as I talked initially, my immediate objective was to know which antibiotics, the rotifer is sensitive to which antibiotic. Now, why antibiotic? What I think is that, as I said, I want to put my gene of my interest into the rotifer. So I thought, why not put a antibiotic resistant gene in it? So first, for that, I wanted to initially observe that which antibiotic to are these rotifers sensitive. So I checked with this four different antibiotics, that is chloramphenicol, tetracycline, gentamicin, streptomycin, and ampicillin as a control. Why ampicillin as a control? It is because ampicillin, as you all know, it disrupts the cell wall formation, and rotifer doesn't have a cell wall. So. Yeah, that was an initial goof up. Initially, I thought that, okay, ampicillin work, and ampicillin resistant bacteria is very easy to find. So I just added different concentrations of ampicillin to the rotifer culture, and nothing happened. I was like, okay. I added, to be precise, I added 100 milligrams, 100 micrograms per ml, 200, 300, 400, 500. Nothing happened at 500. I added 1,000, 2,000, 3,000, 4,000, 5,000. Nothing happened. Then I had a stock, I just added the stock, and I was like, ab to marna chahiye yaar. But no, nothing happened. Then I went, then I was like, why it is not happening? And I just googled a very small thing, the mechanism of ampicillin, how ampicillin works. And I was like, oh man, I am so stupid. Okay, so that is why I chose then ampicillin as a control, because ampicillin won't have any effect on the rotifer, as it just obstructs the cell wall formation, and rotifer being an animal doesn't have a cell wall. So after adding this, again, why 60 micrograms? Because in our college lab, we have the discs which are of 30 micrograms. So I thought 30 is very less, so add 2. I couldn't make it 50 because they were 30 microgram discs. Okay. So looking at the results of this experiment, I don't think they are very reliable because I just did it once, but I did it just few days ago, so I'm showing it to you. Ampicillin, as it was controlled, it was showing growth in the ampicillin. Gentamicin, no rotifers were found, they were all dead. In chloramphenicol, they were all dead, but in tetracycline and streptomycin, they were still present. But as compared to the control, the amount of or the number of rotifers in the tetracycline and streptomycin was less. But I can't say that it just like they were not very sensitive. They were, I can say they were bit sensitive to it. One more thing, what I did was desiccation tolerance and revival. As I said that rotifers undergo desiccation and then they again revive back. So I wanted to check that the culture which I am having, how many of them, like what is the percentage of rotifers can revive back. Okay, so again I took a 96 well plate, and I had that time a good tank of rotifers, so I can use as many as I want. So I just took 10 rotifers in each of the 96 well plate, and I just kept the well plate open for around 2 days, around 4 days, I guess. Okay, I haven't written here. I just kept the well plate open so that all the water will evaporate. And then again, I added two drops of water to each of this well. And I closed it with a lid, and I kept it like that. And I observed it after every hour. Then after observing every hour, I couldn't find any kind of revival. I'm still very much confused regarding it, that why I couldn't see any revival. Because initially, from where I got this rotifers, they were from a dry Pagalapos, and when I put water, they came back to life. So I think they should have come back to life even in while performing this experiment in a 96 well plate, but it didn't happen. I think the reason might be for this, like when I looked how people did it initially, Claudia Ricci, she was the one who did many experiments with the Deloitte rotifers. And when I looked at her methods in the literature, what she always used to do is she used to put some filter paper or something like that in the well plate, so that when the rotifers desiccate, they will adhere to that filter paper or something, and the cyst of this rotifers won't just fly off with the air. So maybe that was the goof of why I couldn't find the revival of this rotifers. But if I do it again, maybe I can find it. 10 rotifers per well, so 96, around 1,000 rotifers. No, I couldn't find it anywhere. It is very less likely, but I don't think that it can happen because I initially got it from the dry itself, so they should revive. Yeah. Yeah, it's using filter paper. Okay, I don't think that would be the case because sometimes it just happened by chance. We didn't do it deliberately, but while looking at the rotifer on our slide, sometimes we just went out for a lunch and while coming back, it was all dried up and it was just kept there. And after some time, someone thought that, okay, let's just put some water and maybe it can revive. And he would just put some water, and while the causerie was going on, he would just make sure that the water don't dry up again. And he used to put water, and by the time we are leaving again around 6-7, he would see the rotifers are again moving. So. I kept checking the first day. I kept checking every hour because I was not knowing. Then the second day again I didn't check it every hour the second day, but in intervals. So it's not like after a gap of 4 days I checked it, but I was checking it in between. It maybe have flown away because, as I said, I just clipped it open to dry. I didn't cover it with any lid or anything after that. Sorry? For the dormancy, for the dorm, they mostly revive back within 4 hours, and the revival rate is around 70-80% in the Lloyds mostly. Sorry, they just as Claudia Ricky did. She just used to keep the well plates open by keeping a filter paper below it. And she stated that so that the tones will adhere to the filter paper and they won't fly away. So that's it. And the goof ups, which the goof ups which I had done, they were obviously lack of maintenance. I didn't maintain my culture very properly. I wasn't very regular coming to the lab. There is a lack of collaboration, as you can see. No one is standing here besides me. there were few from Chennai. Krishnamurti was from Chennai. Adarsh was from Ranchi. A colleague from Elphinstone College himself, Himanshu, was there working with me. But okay, and irregularity in the work. Okay, that's it. Okay. I'm open for your questions.
Okay, any questions, please? Okay, I have one question. Acha.
Okay.
Yeah, because you said that, you know, the rotifers, they don't reproduce sexually.
Yeah.
Most of the time they reproduce asexually, and you said, so variation, how does it come?
By taking the gene transfer.
Taking the DNA of the other species. So the question is that, you know, if they're taking the DNA, you know, no, they should be changing very fast because they are directly taking the chunks of the DNA and incorporating into their genome.
Yeah.
You know, that is not how, random mutation happens very slowly, one mutation at a time, you know. But here they're taking lot of DNA at a time, you know.
But
so they should be evolving very fast.
But all the time mutation does not add up to the genome size. Here it's every time it's adding up to the genome size. So what about the genome size itself?
Yeah.
Okay. You have a clock, a timepiece or a clock working, and you poke it.
Huh.
What is the probability of that running better? You understand what I'm trying to say? A clock is running reasonably okay, and you just go on poking it.
Huh.
What's the probability of it running more efficiently?
Nothing.
What's the probability of it conking off?
Yeah.
more.
So to me, it's something like poking with a finger. It's not that it is picking and choosing the right type of DNA. Right. It is just a random thing happening. So most of the random thing is like you are poking into the machinery of the clock.
Yeah.
Okay. So the point is that what is it that is becoming? Sometimes once in 10 million times or something, you poke into the clock and probably clock is working better. So that doesn't mean that you'll be going on clock.
My
question is different. My question is that if it is taking a lot of DNA, it should be evolving very fast. Okay.
It should be destroying fast itself.
Okay. So. But at least it should happen something very fast. Something very, you know, not should be happening. Unlike what is happening in the random variation.
Mm-hmm.
So in that case, you should be. Can you show one organism evolving into another? Like one rotifer, it is taking some DNA and it is becoming another. For example, another species of a rotifer. Yeah, antibiotic resistance is okay. You can see in bacteria. I don't care about rotifer. I am saying that can you show one species evolving into another species? That's what the evolution you said about.
Okay,
this is a question. Okay, this is a question. So this is a scientific question. And people, scientists are asking these questions.
As you are talking, as the Michelson's paper said, according to their bioinformatics study, what they say is that most of the transfer of the gene which is taking place, it is mostly with the genes related to the enzymes. Okay, I don't know how much I'm answering to your question, but what they say is that it is mostly the parts which are getting changed, they are in the codes, the part which codes for some enzymes in those rotifers. So maybe the phenotypic changes we are not seeing because of that.
Did you finish? Sorry. Okay. He was referring to something very casually, Michelson. I think, is it the same Michelson Stahl?
Yes.
Michelson.
Yes. He's the one who designed a very famous Michelson and Stahl experiment.
Okay. So if you look at from that serious point of view, it is the same serious Michelson talking about it. So what is this? I think you are also talking about enzymes, genes responsible, genes related to enzymes are being modified and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So what could be possibly happening? One of the easiest thing that could be possibly happening is that there will be a homologous recombination that is possible. Homologous recombination. That means some homologous sequences that is coming from a bacteria or some other foreign source, it has got much better probability of getting incorporated into an existing gene which has got homology with those sequences.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So those are the ones that is getting incorporated.
Hmm.
So you have a nice amylase gene, okay, a gene for amylase, which is doing very well for the animal. I'm just using it. And a homologous sequence, which another sequence for foreign DNA has got a homologous sequence, is getting now incorporated into this very finely functioning amylase gene.
Yeah.
Okay. What is the possibility of it getting conging off? Even if it's a homologous transfer, there's a good possibility of the existing amylase gene will be conked.
Yeah.
There is a rare case where this amylase gene will become extremely, extremely fantastic. I'm just using a word amylase, okay.
Yeah.
So the probability, you'll have to just see that my earlier analogy of the clock. Here we are also explaining a mechanism of how homologous recombination can take place. Even in a homologous recombination, the probability of it becoming a aid for the organism to reproducibly multiply, you know, for better reproduction, will be much less. But once it happens, and if it is aiding it, that will go proliferating.
Exactly.
Particularly in a non-conducive atmosphere where all other fellows are very, very meekly functioning, where this fellow will be doing. So the probability is what that we need to worry about. So the probability of it is becoming dull and inefficient is much more than the probability of getting a very, very nice, nicely functioning enzyme coming in. The nicely functioning enzyme also will not be nicely functioning in the given situation. In a changed situation, probably that will be the best one.
Yeah, it can happen.
Is that making sense?
Also, the question rises, is there any mechanism of like horizontal gene transfer? So is it there something horizontal gene elimination? Because it has to maintain its genome size as it is, right? it cannot sustain more than a limit of a genome size in that rotifer. Rotifer is not a higher organism. So have you come across something like, is it, or how frequent is it? Is it not more, is it frequently?
It is very frequent. That is why they call it massive.
Then within 10 years of the time, from one generation to the 50th or the 100th,
yeah,
there should be a large genome expansion.
Okay,
expansion.
So it's a very interesting thing. So I think you should send us all these, some interesting papers.
Yeah.
So the papers must have used some markers. I think you were using a marker antibiotic resistant. So
yeah,
they must have said, they must have concluded that it's massive gene transfer.
Hmm.
Maybe because they have found out several markers when they used it must have been all getting incorporated and
exactly,
many of them are not really becoming deleterious for the organism. So so those papers are very
yeah,
good. It's
yeah,
a fantastic area. Yeah.
Okay, so I think, yeah, we will be breaking for the tea now, so tea and snacks. Yeah, after the tea, we actually are passing you a small paper, a sheet of paper. You, we will be, after this, we will be showing, after one presentation,